And we're live!
Hey guys, hello. Reacting to MasterChef today.
Gonna kill you. You cut me off in my fucking intro. I swear to God. Him and I have been fighting about this intro for fucking months now. It's actually not
been a couple
it's,
weeks.
It's been like 3 or 4 weeks. It's been like since like right before Christmas. Shut up and go. It doesn't matter that you're fourth. But yeah, hello everybody. How are you?
We said we were gonna stream twice every week to start the year, and then we didn't stream even one time last week.
Yeah, because you know, stuff happened.
Would you like to explain what happened?
Yes. So thank you, Echo, for subscribing, the GOAT.
Yo, shout out Echo Saber.
But yeah, so last week it was like right after New Year's. And my sister and her boyfriend, they both started feeling a little sick. And we were like, that's a little weird. It's fine. They're sick. And then my mom started feeling sick, and it seemed like COVID. And we were like, that's cool. That's it's not COVID. We're fine. And so we went out and we got a test, and it was COVID. And so my mom tested positive, and then we all got super sick. And so basically all of last week I was dying. I was very feverish. I could barely speak. You could ask Scott. He would talk to me. We'd talk for work because I tried to work. And I would just cough my ass off. It was very obnoxious. There's no way we could stream on Tuesday because I was super sick. Thursday, we were considering it, at least slightly. But then I tried to talk for about more than 10 minutes and just died. I still, if I talk too long, will start coughing. So if at some point,
it was kind of funny, he would talk, and then if he spoke for more than like 10 seconds at a time, he would run out of air.
I would literally, I would run out of breath. I'm still kind of dealing with it, but not as bad. The breathlessness, at least. I was very, like, walking up and down stairs, I'd get really, really breathless. A lot of chest pain, a lot of physical pain. And like I said, I had a fever for a few days there. So it wasn't the funnest thing. I have to admit that, just being 100% honest, but, you know, I'm over it now. I'm doing better now. Everyone else in my family is doing better now, too. So, hopefully, everything's good from here on out. Just dealing with a rough throat and cough, still. But other than
We're
that,
back.
Things are gold. And yeah, this is our first Tuesday stream. We're live on a Tuesday in the middle of the day.
That's true. It's early.
It is early. I'm sweating because it's hot outside. Even
I made
winter.
Bryce stop work to stream.
That is true. I only got to write 6,000 words today. It was pretty unfortunate.
Unbelievable.
But
this is where Bryce starts waking up at 3:30 in the morning on Tuesdays.
Yeah, on Tuesdays I start getting up at 3:30, getting that extra bit of work in. One Deep Fry said, I'm at the stage where the holidays are over, but I packed baggage on me, and for the last weeks I've been enjoying having a bigger chest and belly. I fell in love. I know they have to go soon. Sad times. That's fair. We all eat during the holidays. I have Christmas weight from 2 years ago. I'm still
doing it. I was going to say you lost that Christmas weight. Yeah.
There we go. I knew it was coming at some point. So what's
this is what I'm actually drawing on stream today.
What, Lucia, is this?
This is pro wrestler Lucia.
Pro wrestler Lucia. Now you and I are both pretty big fans of wrestling.
That's true.
We don't talk about it very often.
In a long time, we would probably talk about it more if we watched it regularly.
That is fair. Yeah, we had this time period where we were really, really into wrestling. I would say there was a point in time, probably about before COVID, where we were watching 4 to 5 hours of wrestling a week, maybe.
Yeah.
Because we were watching
more on pay-per-views.
Yeah, we were watching pay-per-view. We were watching every pay-per-view. So we were watching like WWE pay-per-views, AEW pay-per-views, and New Japan pay-per-views. We were watching, trying to watch AEW weekly shows, WWE weekly shows, NXT weekly shows. Oh yeah, and we watched NXT pay-per-views. Yeah, we were watching it constantly, but then we just fell out of it a little bit.
COVID happened. Nobody was there.
Yeah, we did that for about 3 years though. There were about 3 years where we were watching. We watched just a lot of wrestling.
Yeah, we stopped mostly because when the pandemic happened and there was nobody in the arena, it was just kind of awkward. And I think I've not really watched in a long time, but I think eventually they got better at it. But at first, nobody knew how to do an empty arena show. And so it was really awkward. All the wrestlers were awkward. The announcers, the production, everything was super weird.
Well, especially with something like wrestling where, like, there is no other form of entertainment, I feel like, that relies on a crowd more. Like, it literally can... There are matches that can be incredible matches. Like, everything can be done perfectly, but the crowd cannot give a shit, and it, like, legitimately can ruin the match. It's really weird.
True.
How important a crowd is in wrestling. Yeah, so without a crowd, it really hurt it. And that's why it's kind of why we fell out. Nowadays, we could probably get back into it pretty easily, but we just, you know. We did in DC. We watched CM Punk's return together. That was a cool moment. It was kind of random that it happened. Like, we didn't really plan that.
No, we would probably watch AEW weekly if there were a way to do it, like, streaming.
Easily. It's so difficult to watch AEW. Like, without, like, just, like, actually watching fucking cable TV.
Who the fuck watches cable
TV? That's what I'm saying. It's, like, it's so obnoxious. Well, see, we're Twitch streamers, right? So we should watch cable TV. That's, like, the whole gimmick.
All right. We should watch MasterChef.
Yeah, we should go watch MasterChef.
And we started beef with XQC.
Yeah.
Are we at that stage yet?
The gaming geek said, hi, how you doing?
Great. Lovely. Never been better. That's not true, but yeah, you were real raspy for a couple of days, but you're better now.
Yeah, I had a few days where I actually sent Scott a voice clip of how shitty I sounded. Should I play that if I can find it real quick? Hold on,
if you can find it. Yeah, he sounded like shit, and he was like, I think we're good to stream Thursday. I'm like, listen, I don't want to listen to you for 2 hours.
Yeah, Scott had to basically convince me, like, not to. Multiple times he was like, Bryce, listen, Bryce, you have a fever, you're dying, like, you just go to work. And I'll be like, but we can stream tomorrow, we can do it, like, we can make it work. And you're like, ah, no, hold on, I'm trying to see if I can find it. Can we talk about the John Travolta thing on stream? About his haircut? That's my favorite thing I've learned all
Hold
week.
On. I'm going to pull up a couple pictures of John Travolta, guys. Because I don't know if you guys know what he looks like now. Because when I think of John Travolta, I think of this, right? This sex symbol. That's what I think of now. And then apparently at some point he got old and got this haircut. But then recently, he decided to shave his head, and so he looks like, I just copied the same picture twice, and so he looks like.
Okay, I guess I can't. Fucking serious.
I guess I can't copy that picture from Google. Great. What the fuck?
And now we just sit here in silence.
It won't do it. Hold on. There we go. Yeah, he looks like this now. It's a lot better, actually, but the thing is, he kind of looks like Joe Rogan.
And Scott's been obsessed with this for a while.
Yeah, some pictures he looks like Joe Rogan more than others. I'm trying to find the one. There's one that's, like, shockingly similar. But I don't have it. He also kind of looks like Alexander Volkanovsky for a reference.
He stepped into Johnny Sins territory. That's fair.
Yeah, right here. That's just, you can't tell me that's not Joe Rogan.
That is fair. That's kind of crazy. He looks good though.
Good for John Travolta.
He rocks the bald hair.
Can we get John Travolta on stream?
The problem is I just sent you this dumbass voice clip randomly, so there's like, I'm sorting through a million messages right now. I'm just looking for this voice clip. I did see that at one point I said I deadass feel so weak I'm drinking Powerade right now. I don't remember saying that, but
I remember that. That's how I knew you were really sick.
I was going to say, that's how you know I
resorted to drinking Powerade.
That's how you know I was fucked up. I was drinking Powerade.
I was also sick around the time, but not COVID sick.
Yeah, I'm like dying of COVID. He's like, yeah, my throat hurts a little bit.
I had a stuffy nose. It was, you know, it was a lot to deal with.
Hold on. Oh, I found it. Okay, hold on. Let me get this played. I don't know what I said in this. I think I just made fun of him over here. I'm gonna play it.
This is what I sound like right now. This is not an exaggeration. Even if I clear my throat, I still sound like it. I'm dying.
So that's what I sounded like when I had COVID. That's what I sounded like all of last week. It was not a fun time. I still actually, you probably don't hear it as much now, but my voice is still a little different. I still sound a little bit raspy, at least compared to how I normally do.
Would you recommend COVID?
No, I wouldn't. I wouldn't say it's a great thing to get. I wouldn't say it's a great thing to get. That wasn't intentional.
Yeah.
But yeah. Yeah, Ingo's right. I should have streamed with that voice. That's total ASMR voice.
It would have been content. But it might have killed you, is the problem.
It might have killed the stream. People might have never come back. There was a point, though, where I was legitimately worried. I was like, what if my voice never changes back? What if I'm stuck like this? Like, how? Like, what do I do from now on? How do I stream like this?
But I'm telling you, it'd be content. People would like it.
It's all good now. I just have to drink a lot of water.
You just sound like Steve-O.
That is fair. I did kind of sound like Steve-O.
I was reading an article and it was like, why Steve-O sounds the way he does. And it was like, he talked to a throat doctor and the doctor said he doesn't use his vocal cords. He just speaks with the muscles in his throat. And that sounded very painful, which I guess that makes sense because the way that Steve-O speaks sounds very painful.
There is nothing better than watching, like, Steve-O's podcast. It's, like, the wildest shit I've ever heard. Because, like, it's strangely really wholesome. Like, it's like, legitimately, like, pretty chill. He's a pretty cool dude. But then it'll be like, yeah, so, like, 10 years ago, I was shoving, like, needles up my ass. And I broke through a wall. And Johnny Knoxville was like, why'd you take all this heroin? And I was like, I just did it for fun. And it's, like, crazy. It's, like, the wildest shit. I watch it all the time. I'm a big Steve-O fan.
Are you Steve-O on stream?
Yeah. Remember that time he protested SeaWorld and he just climbed to the top of that fucking billboard?
I do.
Like, come on. He's a fucking legend. He's the goddamn GOAT. The Gaming Geek said, how do you come up with your poses?
I've just drawn a lot. I spent a lot of time in my earlier years doing gesture drawing and figure studies where I just drew poses from real life. I went to websites like Pixel Lovely and Line of Action, whatever it's called now. And I just spent a lot of time, like every day I would fill up pages and pages of just really quick poses. And if you do that enough and you get your anatomy to the point eventually where you can just like, you can just bang out poses like nothing. Now, I mean, I still use reference sometimes. Like, if there's a... I think this pose I might have had reference for on the left. But it still helps if you use reference. But I find that I'm able to do it now without it. And that's really helpful for comics, especially, like, when I'm drawing a book. Because that way I don't have to look up reference for several poses every page. It's all kind of just stored in my memory bank.
Just do that.
But there's nothing inherently better about doing that as opposed to like using reference, though. Like, the only thing it really saves is time. And the poses are slightly worse, which is fine for comics. But like I said, if you're doing illustration, there's nothing wrong with just looking at reference of poses and basing it off of that. There's a weird thing I've noticed that I don't know if any of you guys have experienced it, but I've noticed talking to some of my art friends where, like, there's a level that you get when you study poses where you reach this point. I experienced this as well, but I kind of passed this eventually. You get good at drawing poses from imagination, and it actually becomes difficult to draw poses with reference. Like, for some reason, it's just harder. I don't really know why that is, but eventually you do grow out of it. But there was, like, a long time where I didn't use reference just because it was actually harder than drawing from imagination for me. I don't know, maybe I was just bad at it, but I've heard other people go through it as well. It just takes a little more experience and training to get out of. Bryce, what's your experience with figure drawing?
I remember when I was drawing back in the day a little bit, you sent me a website to go to, and you were like, use this, and it was just naked people.
That's figure drawing.
That's all. It was just like, it was just a bunch of dicks and titties, and you were just like, use this, and I was like, huh. That's it. That's my entire experience with it.
I have to open up another folder. Hide my screen momentarily.
Okay, give me a second. You're good.
Should be good in just a second.
Also, Scott, I don't know if you saw, we got a response to that one thing.
Oh, Julian?
Yeah.
Yeah. But, yeah.
Wow, Scott, why'd you want me to hide your screen, huh? Did you open something lewd?
A little bit.
Wow.
A little bit, I did. A little bit, I did do that, indeed.
Wow.
I'm that guy.
Ingo's calling you out for not announcing on Twitter.
Yeah, well, I just posted a post sheet.
Yo, Fly, thank you for subscribing, the goat.
Yo, thanks, Fly. Damn, Fly and Echo in the same stream. Yeah, Ingo, Twitter doesn't like when you post two times back-to-back. It just decides to kill one of the posts randomly. So I might post on Twitter a little bit, but we're doing all right without it, actually.
It's because we added that long title.
That's true, actually.
Yeah, we said how many words can we fit in the title?
Well, we were looking around Twitch and we realized that people just they like to use a lot of words. It's like anime now, how you see how many words you can put in your title. Yeah, that's still a trend in anime, right? And so that wasn't four or five years ago.
No, that's still a thing.
Okay, great.
God, I hate this. It's better than last week.
I remember when I had bronchitis.
I've never had bronchitis. I've never really dealt with any throat stuff. Like I've only had strep, I think maybe once in my life if I ever have.
Same.
yeah, and so like I'm not used to like coughing or having throat stuff. Like I have sinus problems all the time, so I'm used to that. So, like, last week, there was one point where I was sneezing up blood. Like that was easier to me than coughing. Guys, I hate coughing. I hate coughing a lot. And
Yeah?
Lost user said, I will continue to make... Oh, also, hi, Lost user. I will continue to make Scott the Waz references in the stream till the day I die. I mean, that's good. Scott's the GOAT. He's better than my Scott.
Get Scott the Waz on stream?
I don't think he'd want to talk to you.
He might.
I think you draw stuff too lewd.
Is that true?
I said, what the fuck? I just noticed the new stream overlay. That's true. Yeah, we actually have an overlay now. It's great. We set the Twitch chat to a color, and we were like, it'll be perfect, because now they can see it. And then Scott chose a background that literally negates the color.
I just noticed that,
yeah,
yes.
Yeah.
I'm going to turn that off for a moment.
Thank you. But yeah, And so,
really funny.
Yeah, we actually went through like 10. Basically, my only work I could do last week, my fucking voice cracked there. Basically, the only work I could do last week was like grunt work shit like this. We must have redone this overlay like 15 times. This took so much.
At one point,
I made one because I was frustrated about how it was going. And that
I also made one from scratch.
Yeah, but eventually, and then we spent like $40 for something we only needed to spend like $5 for. It was a whole fucking mess, but we're happy with the way it turned out.
We're determined to get good at Twitch, guys. We're gonna do it. That was our New Year's resolution, which we would have talked about on
had I not been dying. I was so legitimately mad last week. I was so, like, I got COVID and like I like my mom tested positive and I was like, God damn it! I wasn't like mad at her, but I came back in and I sat there for a minute and I was like, we had literally two nights prior sat there talking and we were like, we're gonna do all this shit this month or this year. We're gonna fucking start up with a bang. First fucking week of the year, we're gonna stream twice. We're gonna do all this blah blah. And then like literally the next day, the COVID shit happened. Couldn't believe it. But we're here now.
Year's been pretty good besides that.
Yeah.
You know, outside of that first week, which has been most of the year so far.
Hive Mind said, looks awesome, but the thing at the bottom left takes up too much room. Yeah, we actually talked about that a little bit before stream. But that's that's not something we can quick fix. So we have to actually like.
It'll be better next stream. It'll be better Thursday.
Yeah. So it'll also, when we have other people on, like the picture and the name will change. It'll be nice. But yeah, we do think that's a little bit too big.
Look, we're not perfect, guys. We're not perfect. We're trying.
Also, Josh said, I'm currently working on the 6th Disney fan arts. I hope that goes well for you. That the thing you posted looked cool. If I'm thinking
Disney gonna bring the fucking copyright hammer on Josh the Dreamer. They probably won't.
Until the post blows up and you become the biggest person on Twitter. That's my prediction for the year.
Literally size wise. They don't tell you this, but the larger your Twitter following, you actually grow taller. I've tripled in size since the last
year.
That's
not true. You're still 6 foot.
Eh.
Didn't you tell me you once went to the doctor and they said you were the wrong height and you got really upset about it?
They said, this one nurse tried to say, like, she did the measurement and she's like, 5'11". I'm like, no, do it again. She's like, what? I'm like, do it again. And she measured me again and it was 6 foot. I'm like, that's what I thought. I know, I done been new.
Also, Majin said, who are you talking about? Josh the Dreamer. He's one of the people in our Discord and in our Twitch chats. Also, follow him on Twitter. He makes
cool
good
art. Guy.
He does make cool art. Being the biggest person on Twitter sounds like being crowned the king of hell.
Kind of. It's like, well, I'm not going to say that. But
okay.
Don't worry about it. I'll tell you later.
Anyway, yeah, but you know, your ego's big enough that you would thrive in it. Just like you thrive all. You're never stressed out.
Never one time, actually. It's crazy.
You've never been stressed out.
I was so stressed out earlier this week or last week or whenever that I stressed Bryce out. Like, he came to me a couple days later and he was like, "Bro, like, you were telling me how stressed you were. Like, I was stressed out for 3 days."
This is true. Scott was talking to me about how stressed he was, and he was like telling me all this stuff. He's like, "I have to draw this and do this and do that," and he was like just going and going and going. And like the next day I was like sitting there and I was like, I don't know. I felt all of his stress. I don't know how it happened. It fucked me up for like 2 days. At one point he called me a failure.
That's not true.
That is true.
I called us both failures.
That is true. There was a part in this conversation where Scott called us both failures. And it was a stressful time for both of us. And this was while I had COVID. So like I had COVID, I was like, I need to work more. What am I doing with my life? I'm a failure.
No, just one half of a failed team.
Gaia Yami said, "Hey, hello." And Fly said, "Is there a specific theme with this outfit? It's pro wrestler, Lucia."
Pro wrestling Lucia.
This is her Kenny Omega outfit.
Yeah. Her finisher is the V-trigger.
Everyone, if you don't like wrestling or haven't watched wrestling, I would recommend watching it. I would recommend watching a Kenny Omega match. I feel like Kenny's a good person to sell.
I don't know if that's a great intro
to wrestling.
I
would say go watch his hour-long match with Okada and then watch
the
other.
Yeah, I don't know that the best intro is, hey, go spend an hour and a half watching this wrestling match.
Now, who would you if you had to recommend one match to get someone into wrestling, what would you recommend?
Honestly, probably something comical. Just like really high entertainment value. Or either that or something just like real shit to the point. Maybe like Hardy versus The Undertaker.
Oh, that is fair. Jeff versus CM Punk would be my pick if you pick the Jeff Hardy match. But see, I feel like you shouldn't go like a TLC or like a tables match or anything like that. Because they're like kind of gimmicky.
They're pretty gimmicky.
If you were to go from like... See, I feel like it's kind of hard because there's a lot of different kinds of wrestling and people will like... the different kinds. Like, some people like storytelling wrestling. And if you like that, I would say go watch Gargano Ciampa 1. Like, I feel like that's the best storytelling wrestling, or one of the best I've ever seen. Like, if you like,
I hate this blue.
If you just like really good technical wrestling, you have like Okada versus Omega. One, they've wrestled four times. Really, you can watch any of them. But
I've never hated a color more than I hate this blue and yellow combination that I've laid down. I need to fix this.
We gotta get Bacon in here to tell you that it's wrong.
I know that it's wrong though. That's the thing. I'm having a time with it.
Purple Haze said, "Hey everyone, hello."
Hey.
We've been going for 30 minutes and my throat's already hurting.
What about this? Is this better? That's ass.
This is a color that, Scott, I know, man. And I were watching wrestling and you saw a wrestler come with this color, you'd be shitting all over it.
I would be fuming. I'm fuming right now, actually, is the thing.
Josh said try yellow and black.
That's really bright. I'm determined to do blue, though. Although green's kind of fucking sick, I'm not gonna lie. But I just did green in an outfit, so I kind of want to do blue.
Yeah, it's fair. The green police are gonna come after you.
Yeah. If you do too much green, you actually get arrested.
Everyone's saying black. Just some combination in black.
I don't like this blue. This, like, baby blue.
Give her Macho Man colors. One thing I would definitely not recommend is watching a lot of, like, old wrestling as your first wrestling. Because the wrestling in a lot of the old matches actually aren't that good. Unless you're watching, like, Shawn Michaels. Shawn Michaels is good in every match. Watch Shawn Michaels versus Hulk Hogan as your first match, actually. That's my recommendation. So talking about watching a funny match. The Shawn Michaels versus Hulk Hogan match. Hulk Hogan never liked to lose. And Shawn had to lose to him. And so he sold everything like it was death. Like, there's one part where Hulk Hogan throws a punch and Shawn Michaels literally throws himself out of the ring. Like, he jumps backwards, hits the ropes, falls through them, and fucking, like, rolls across the ring. It's hilarious. It's one of my favorite
wrestlers. It's very comical.
It's very good. You know what I would probably recommend, to just being honest, just off top? Because I feel like it's fun. I feel like it has a good story. And I feel like it's relatively quick. I'd recommend the three-way between Rollins, Lesnar, and Cena.
The good one.
Because you got Lesnar throwing people around, and that's always fun. There's one point where he suplexes Seth Rollins, and I swear to God, he throws him from one end of the ring to the other. And, like, almost out of it. It's fucking
crazy.
He
throws this little fucker, like, 25 feet across the ring.
He fucking picks Seth Rollins up, and he launches it. There's one point where Brock Lesnar suplexes two people at once in that match. Because, like, Seth has these two fucking geeks. It's also one of Cena's best matches. Cena's pretty hit or miss. It's a very good match.
Really, any match with Brock Lesnar throwing people around?
Honestly,
it's a good time.
Like, really? Yeah, I was going to say, you can watch a lot of Brock Lesnar matches, and they're pretty fun. They're just the same thing over and over. That's the only problem. Your first Brock Lesnar match, though, will be a cathartic experience. As long as you don't watch that, his 19th match with Roman Reigns at WrestleMania, like, 36, where he fucking busts him open with that elbow. That's the only one I wouldn't recommend.
You know, they're wrestling at WrestleMania again this
year.
Are
you kidding me? Are they headlining again?
They are.
Is that the fourth time they're headlining WrestleMania?
I think it is, yes.
Oh my god. I thought they were done with that whole gimmick.
Well, they were, but then they just did it again. See, now Roman's a heel and Brock is the face, so.
Yeah, there was one of their wrestlers, because like I said, for some reason they love doing Roman Reigns and Brock Lesnar at WrestleMania. Where Brock shoot means he actually does it, like it's not fake wrestling shit, fucking elbowed Roman in the head and busted him square open. Oh my god, it's gnarly. It's just Roman laying there gushing blood for like the last like 5 minutes of the match. It was one of the, I watch MMA, I've seen plenty of people get cut open. It was one of the few times I was uncomfortable watching wrestling with how much Roman was bleeding. It was gnarly. If you had to recommend like some kind of hardcore match, what hardcore match would you recommend? The right answer is Randy Orton versus
Mick Foley.
Cactus Jack, first of all. Please get it right, Scott. They're different characters.
That has the thumbtacks in it.
That does. That has the one of the gnarliest thumbtack spots I've ever seen. When fucking he throws Randy in these thumbtacks, and Randy gets them all over him and has to go into the back and have them pull them out of his hands because he has so many in his hands. I don't know if we're selling wrestling or not. Like, I don't know if we're doing.
Yeah, I don't know if anyone would ever watch wrestling again if you showed them that match.
Yeah, don't watch that as your first match. Don't watch the Randy Orton Cactus Jack match. Really, don't watch any Cactus Jack, Mankind, Mick Foley match as your first match. They're all great, but they're just not great introductions.
Hell in a Cell, first match.
Josh said, Echo did mention the Undertaker, Mankind, Hell in a Cell. Also,
I'm like something announced table.
Lost user said three-way. Yeah, in wrestling, when three people wrestle at once, it's called a three-way. Actually, it's not called a three. What's it called? Triple threat.
Triple threat.
But people just say like it's a three-way wrestling match.
Well, it is a three-way. It's just called a triple threat.
Josh said, do you guys remember Mucha Lucha? Is that the cartoon?
I think that's the cartoon, but I don't remember.
Is that what that is? I vaguely remember this. Very vaguely. It's kind of weird. I didn't watch Wrestle. Scott, you turned the blue back on and fucked the.
It has to be on again. It just has to be.
Sorry.
Can people. You not change it from the.
Oh, you know, I can't change it right now.
Change it to, like, I don't know. Guys, what color should your text be when you type? Change it to yellow.
Yellow? Like piss yellow?
Not piss yellow.
Okay, I made it piss yellow.
Like cool yellow.
I made it piss yellow. So there you go. It's piss yellow for now. And this is what it'll be.
Sorry, guys. He made you piss yellow.
I gotta change it because the yellow on her outfit, you still can't see it.
Pick a color that I'm not using.
I know, that's the problem.
I'm really not using that many. I'm using like three.
We'll go bright ass red.
Ass red?
Ass red. We'll see how long we can stomach that. This will be the stream where we just constantly change it. Every few minutes.
We'll rainbow go to colors.
But, yeah, for hardcore matches, Veltros said red is ass. That was the first one. But, like, with the question mark, that really makes it. Red is ass?
Red ass?
I can't find a color I like for the chat. I just keep changing it. Maybe I'll make it solid black.
I don't know if anyone would, I don't know.
We'll just keep it as red for now. Maybe we'll just turn it off.
Yeah, fuck you, chat.
We'll just get rid of it.
We'll actually disable the chat. We're all gonna sit here in silence.
But I feel like the Shawn Michaels Triple H Hell in a Cell is like that match is really long, but that's a good hardcore match. Their first
great match. I don't know if you said it's long.
It is long. It also has the I hate the finish of that match where he pedigrees him three times and it goes on for like 15 minutes. But I guess that's enough talk about wrestling. Don't watch WWE, right. Though that would be my one recommendation.
Sorry, guys. We get to talk about wrestling once a year, and we just burned it.
If you want to get into wrestling, AEW or New Japan, don't watch WWE. My advice.
How are we feeling about this blue that I've picked today?
I like it. I think it's good. Sketch said colors in the suit look good.
Well, if Sketch, I didn't care when you said it, but if Sketch says it,
it definitely looks better than that gross ass blue you had before. I'll say it. I thought it was gross from the start. I just didn't want to upset you.
I also thought
it was gross. I didn't want you to tell me I was a failure again. We've already been through that once.
He's never gonna let this go.
Never.
I come to you to vent my frustrations, and this is how you repay me.
You can vent your frustrations, but like, I'm not saying that. It's great. I'm glad you vented to me. I'm glad you trust me. I don't trust you. So, like, it's, you know, it's a cool thing. But you told me I was a failure, and I couldn't even write that day because I was sick. And so I couldn't even avenge it.
Well, it's also, like, 10:30 at night.
Yeah, but you know how I am. That's why I've written, like, on Monday and Tuesday, I've written, like, 10,000 words already this week. I'm not a failure, goddammit. I told him he made me feel like I had a dad that hated me. That's how I felt when he said that to me.
It's okay. I do have a dad that hates me, so
Majin Izzy said, Scott, yeah, your dad fucked up and had another kid to replace you.
That's true. I have a little Asian sister, if you guys didn't know.
That you've never met, that doesn't even live in your country.
That's that, like, I've never met and is also 21 years older than, or younger than me.
But Majin Izzy said, Scott, are you okay?
Hey, I'm having a good time. I got all my frustrations out on Bryce that one night.
Said, wait, what?
Wait, what?
Scott's dad is a whole ass story. We got to tell in stream someday.
Like, that'll someday, be a sub-goal one
that,
day.
That's got to be, like, a stream subject. Like, that can't just be done in, like, one little quick story. Scott's dad is a wild story. Really, Scott's whole family. Get a lot of wild stories out of him.
My life. I'll just tell my life story one stream.
Yeah, we'll do it like a draw my life. We'll take it back to like 2012.
Like our 500 sub goal will be me just telling my entire life. Yo, shout out to draw my life. It took me a minute to register what you said.
That was like the trend in like 2013, 2014.
It sure was.
Everyone did one. If you go to some big channel still today, it's like their pinned video is the draw my life video.
It's also really funny because a lot of channels that weren't artists also did it, and it was like,
well, that was the gimmick. I feel like more people that weren't artists did it, or they just had the sketch or the whiteboard, and they would just do like little stick figures. What would her finishing move be, Scott, as a wrestler?
Spinning tombstone pile driver.
That's a fair point. You said that on Discord the other day. I was just gonna see if you were consistent. We could talk about Veldrals asked a pretty interesting question in Discord the other night that we talked about a little bit personally, but we could talk about that here. Bye, Majin Izzy. I hope you have fun.
Bye, Majin Izzy.
But yeah, we talked about it a little bit, but if you want, we can talk about it here more. Veldral said, hell yeah.
Well, since you brought it up, sure.
So I think just going off memory, the question was, if you could pick one rap song to encapsulate, if you were to show it to somebody, to encapsulate all of rap. I don't think it was everything you like about rap. It was just specifically what hip-hop is as a whole, right?
The essence of hip-hop, what would I think you it pick? Was worded.
And you said, Can I Kick It, right?
I said, Can I Kick It, but really you could use any number of Tribe Called Quest songs.
Yeah, I forget what I said when we talked about it, when you and I talked about it. Because I named a bunch. I didn't have like one. I know I said Fuck the Police is one of them by N.W.A.
The reason I picked Tribe Called Quest and any of that is that I think, to me, that's like, I don't know, it just, when you think of hip-hop, that's what I think of. It's old. I think everything after that is an iteration on that style. Even the, like, really poppy stuff today. So when I think of just what is hip hop, I can't help but think of that really old school kind of stuff, like Tribe Called Quest and Wu-Tang or just anybody like that.
I feel like Bring the Ruckus would probably be mine, the Wu-Tang song. That's because that I feel like that song encapsulates what I like about hip hop at least.
It's just some dudes sitting back and like rhyming over a good beat, and it's very fun. It has attitude, and it's just a lot of fun. That's what I like about hip hop, and that's what I think hip hop is.
Yeah, I think like that's why, especially with the old albums, that's why we get so many off there. Is because like Wu-Tang and Tribe Called Quest and all those albums, they just kind of feel like that. Actually, is like one of my favorite openings to any song. What Veldros just quoted, I don't want to say, I don't want to get TOS'd. Yeah, I feel like those all have that sort of sitting on a porch, just kind of flipping it back and forth kind of feel.
Yeah, well, I mean, hip-hop started with just, like, dudes sitting on a porch, you know, rhyming. And early hip-hop, that's what it feels like. And, I mean, even all the way back to, like, Beastie Boys, it feels like that. But I feel like when you get to the Wu-Tang era, when you get to the Tribe era, that's when, like, a lot of the techniques that are still really popular today in actual rap started to emerge.
Hmm.
And I think that That's just like, that's why I think everything today, even like everything from the really poppy, you know, whatever, the Drakes, to like hyper technical stuff like Black Thought, like all of that, it emerged from that era.
Yeah, I feel like the further you go, Scott and I listened to a lot of hip hop, and I listened to specifically a lot of old school hip hop, but I'd actually never listened to a Biggie album. And so Scott and I, this weekend, we played Civilization and listened to, what fucking album's it called, Scott?
Ready to Die.
Yeah, Ready to Die. That album's incredible. That album is fantastic. I'm probably the only person that likes hip hop, especially old school hip hop, that's not listened to Ready to Die before, but it's really fucking good.
Give Me the Loot, one of the best rap songs of all time.
Just the Dreamer said, Bryce, when you feel better, you're still going to dye your hair on stream. Yeah, I'm not going to dye it on stream. Like, it's not going to be a thing we stream. But yeah, I'm going to...
Unless.
Yeah.
Subcool.
but I, yeah, I'm going to... I had an appointment for the 14th, but I had to cancel it because I have to quarantine still. I had to cancel my appointment in December because we had a COVID scare in December. And so I canceled that, and then I fucking caught COVID, and so I'm quarantining still. And so I'm hoping to get
it done. Did your stylist also get COVID?
Oh, yeah. The person that was going to do my hair also got COVID. Like, I messaged her, and I canceled, and she was like, oh, no, it's cool. I also got COVID. Like, it was just a week ago. And I was like, God damn, everyone's fucking getting COVID.
That's Omicron for you.
That's fucking everyone. Scott, you live in somewhere rural as fuck, thankfully. Comparatively, at least. You had that head cold, though.
Yeah, my nose was so dry that it started bleeding. It was not fun. I mean, it was better than COVID, but it was no good. It was no buys.
I've only ever had a nosebleed once in my life.
Is that true?
Mm-hmm. I have had, like, a legitimate, like, blood gushing out of my nose. Yeah, you and I were playing NHL when we were like 13 or 14, and we were playing League. I don't know if you remember this. And my nose started gushing blood randomly, and we were losing by like 4 goals, and I had to run out of my room because I got blood all over my controller and shit, and I had to fucking clean my controller off. I had to shove fucking paper towels up my nose. I came back and fucking kept playing the game, and we fucking scored like 4 goals in a row and won. That's the only other time I've ever gotten nosebleed. It just happened randomly, too. I have no idea why it happened. It's never happened since.
I don't know if this actually counts, but the worst nosebleed that I ever got was when my friend Elijah hit me in the nose with a baseball bat on accident, full swing.
It's the most Elijah story I've ever heard. I almost, knowing Elijah, I bet he asked if he could do it. You said yeah, didn't he?
No, what really? It was is we were just, like, hanging out in the backyard, and we were playing ball, and we were just, like, tossing around the baseball and like taking turns hitting it, and once we hit all of the balls far away, we had to go and pick them up. And when we were picking them up, he was doing this thing where he would pick one up, and then instead of throwing it back to home plate, he would hit it back, like he just throw it up in the air and hit it. And he did that once and didn't know that I was behind him, and I also was bending down to pick up a ball, and I didn't know he was going to do that. So when I stood up from picking up the ball, his backswing from the bat came around and hit me in the nose. It was like a waterfall. I don't know how it didn't break.
Was Elijah the one that almost killed you with the sword when you were younger?
No, that was CJ. Yeah, me and my friend CJ were just hanging out in my garage as a kid, and I had a sword. I don't know why I had a sword as like an 8-year-old.
I feel like every boy I knew had a sword. It's like I had a sword when I was a kid, too. And I think Brandon did, too. I don't know how we all got swords.
Yeah, we probably shouldn't have had
swords. I was going to say, we definitely shouldn't have, but like legitimate, like Japanese, like fake, like they were, the ones I had were relatively dull because they were old as fuck, but.
Yeah, what we were doing in the garage is we were just like, we would pick up a floppy disk, right? And we would throw it at each other. And then we would try and cut the floppy disk in half. And he did that one time and the sword broke off of the handle. And the blade went flying across the garage and stuck into the wall. Scariest shit I've ever seen.
There you go.
Next stream, reacting to almost getting killed by a sword. Gone sexual.
Aside that, so with that and your the crash, would that be the only time you've almost died?
Probably. Like, it only times that I've directly, like, had my life flash before my eyes, and knew it. Yeah.
I'm trying to think. I don't think I've ever had a time where I did have a I had a time where me and my mom almost got into a really bad wreck. I mean, like, legitimately, like, my mom was, like, hyperventilating, like, almost got into a wreck because this dude fucking, like, yanked out of a parking lot and almost slammed, like, straight into my door when I was, like, 10. I remember that very vividly. Other than that, I can't. My dad tells this story all the time. Anytime I talk about, like, anything with my life, any injury or anything. So there was some time when I don't remember this at all. I was like 5, 6. There was this, do you remember wooden playgrounds when they used to have wooden playgrounds and, like, they'd actually have metal instead of just, like, the plastic ones they have now? Yeah. So when I was a kid, like I said, I was like 5 or 6, I was at one of those wooden playgrounds. You know, they'd be wooden and it'd be like, everything would be metal that could be. So, like, a jungle gym would be metal, or like the thing, the monkey bars would be metal, and then it'd have like mulch just all over the ground. And I don't know exactly what I was doing, but the way my dad's always described it, which sounds really crazy that this is what I was doing. I was walking on top of the monkey bars. Like, I wasn't, you know, you climb across them. I was standing on them and, like, trying to balance my foot through them, like, walking through them. And I slipped through. Like, I fell between two monkey bars. And my dad said my chin was literally, like, just, like, barely an inch from conking on one of the metal bars and, like, shattering all my teeth. And he said he watched it happen. And he, like, ran to me and grabbed me. He was freaking out. He was hyperventilating. And he said I started crying because he started crying. And he said he was like, are you okay? Are you okay? And he said I looked at him and I was like, are you mad at me? Are we still going to get McDonald's? And I was, like, freaking out because I thought I wasn't going to get McDonald's because I did something wrong. And that's, I guess that's the closest I've come, although I don't remember it at all.
Everyone, chat, tell us about your near-death experiences.
Nah, I can't think of anything else. I've had, like, stupid injuries. Also, real quick, Drakenator said, hey, I saw your drawings on Twitter. You are a great artist.
Thank you, Drakenator. Are you related to the Baconator?
Or Drake? Dre?
Or Drake? Dre?
Also, I'll read your message in a second. He listed out some songs. I have some pretty stupid injuries that I've gotten. One of them, probably the stupidest injury I have, is the burn on my arm. I have a burn on my arm. This story is so fucking stupid. sorry. When I was like 13, me and my friend Brandon and some other friends. Brandon's a good close friend of mine. He's a good guy. So a lot of my stories from middle school, because I was really close in the middle school, are about him. we were hanging out in his living room, and I don't remember what we were doing. We were, like, playing games on Xbox. It was him, me, and two other people. And one of the guys, my friend, he, like, pulled his sleeve up and he was like, I got this lighter burn on my sleeve. Means I'm pretty badass. And this other kid, Jake, like, pulled it up and he was like, I got this lighter burn on me, means I'm pretty badass, and I want it to be badass. And I was like, fucking burn me with the lighter, bros, let's fucking do it, let's go. And so they fucking pulled out, not like a normal lighter, like one of these big ass light, like it was a normal Bic lighter, but like 5 times the size. I don't know where the fuck they got it. I don't know what it is. I've never seen one since. I've only ever seen it there. And they lit it, and what they did was, like, they held it and they kept it lit so the metal heated up. And then they took two other lighters and they put those on the metal. Like, they lit it and they held it against the metal so it would heat up. And they held that against my skin. And so I have a burn on my arm just from me trying to be a badass when I was like 13. I still have it too. It's very, like, if I pull my sleeve up, it's very noticeable. I had a doctor ask me what it was once because he said it looks like fucking, oh, I forget what he said. It was like, it looks like something they do for parasites or something. He was like, why would you have that? What happened? Are you okay? And I'm like, oh, no, it's a lighter burn. I'm stupid. That's about that's probably my dumbest injury. Do you have a dumb injury? Aside from Elijah hitting you in the face with a baseball bat.
No, that's probably the dumbest one. I've gotten injured playing sports, but luckily I've not had a horrible injury really. I have no lighter burns.
Yeah, I slit my finger open on a rusty window once. That's also a pretty dumb injury. Not like dumb as in like, I mean, I have a scar from it, but that's just dumb in terms of like, I did it and was just like, I'm fine. I just kept going. I was like 13. So that definitely wasn't my crowning moment. That was also with Brandon. So things didn't go well in middle school and high school when I was hanging out with Brandon.
When I was a young kid, I was taken I'm from the South. Let me preface this. I was taken to a gun and knife show. And I picked up a knife on a table and I cut the tip of my pinky, and it had to be, I don't even think I got stitches, but it bled a lot. I don't remember how or why I did it. I think I just accidentally cut myself with it because I was very small, like under 10.
Shout out the gun and knife shows. That's the most Southern thing I've ever heard.
Supervise your kids at a gun and knife show, folks. If you take
Ingo them. Said, I also got a burn scar, not from a lighter. Am I still a bad? You can hear my voice is snapping back into last week. I also got a burn scar. It isn't from a lighter. Am I still a badass? It's just, did your friends hold the lighter up to you? And then when you were writhing, I actually didn't feel any pain from it because like it burned my nerves. So like they did it, and I was just like, oh, okay. And they just sat there laughing the whole time. So that was a cool moment in my life.
Oh, does a dumb injury count losing the use of the nerves in the end of my finger?
No, that doesn't count. Not in the way we're talking. Oh,
okay.
Because that was for work. That wasn't like, hey, bro, you want to be cool? Can I burn your hand with a lighter?
That was a sacrifice. Not intentional, really, but it did happen. That's probably my most lasting injury.
I'm trying to think if I've had any stupid injuries aside from... like those.
Your birth was a pretty stupid injury, nerd.
Fucking got me. No, I can't. I'm not a very dumb person. I'm pretty smart. Well, let's be real. Be real was real. Shout out
Bryce was setting up the stream stuff the other week, and he was like, "Can you like? I can't get the font to work. I installed the font just like you said. It won't work." And I'm like, "Did you close the program and reopen it?" And he's like, well, I don't think that'll fix it. And then he did. And he's like, oh, that fixed it.
Thanks. That's why it took a week to get progress made, because I was the one doing
it. Yeah.
Scott does this thing where so basically, whenever I'm not writing comics, my job is to just do everything else we need done. So it's like, that's why I made the website and I made the Patreon. And I like, anytime anything gets made, like the Gumroad and the stuff we just made. Should we tell the you said the Reddit thing was a long story. Do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, it's not really a long story to tell.
So also real quick, if you don't know, we have a Reddit and a Gumroad now.
Yeah.
So the subreddit is just r/ScottMallon. The Gumroad is Bryce and Scott, and it's just all the same stuff on Patreon, just on Gumroad if you'd rather do that. So
yeah, we had some people that told us they wanted, they didn't use Patreon or they didn't want to use Patreon, so they'd rather have a Gumroad. So we just did the Gumroad. If you're already subscribed to the Patreon, don't worry about it. There's nothing new on there for you. It was just more options for people. But yeah, the Reddit was, somebody started a Reddit, or subreddit that was, the purpose was just to repost like the paid Patreon artwork. And somebody brought that to my attention. So I had to message the guy who made it and ask him very politely and respectfully to, stop.
He was very nice.
He was very nice. And he obliged, and he shut the subreddit down just entirely. And then I was like, well, instead of shutting it down, like, just give me and Bryce mod, but like give the subreddit over to us, and we'll actually use it and post stuff on here. And he obliged that as well. And so we have a subreddit now. See, sometimes if you're nice to people, they'll be nice to you back.
And yeah, so now we have a subreddit. That's why it says it was made 6 months ago.
Yeah. It apparently had been around for a while.
But yeah, it It's so yeah, so that's just a place that people can go and do stuff.
If you already have a Reddit account, stop by and say hello. You can look through Bryce's old...
I was going to say, look through Scott's post history. You can see our Reddit post history.
Yeah, it's mainly just baseball posts.
Yeah, I was going to say, if you go to Scott, it's 90% him just talking about baseball.
And arguing with random people in the comments.
That is true. Scott does get pretty... If you want to see feisty Scott, go look at his Reddit and look at him in baseball chats. When people start talking about this, Scott gets pretty feisty on r/baseball.
Bryce's is just writing prompts.
Yeah.
So if you want to read Bryce's writing prompts.
I had about 2 years there where there was like 2 years where it was 2 months. It was a really short, I posted writing prompts for about 2 years, but there was this like, fuck, Jesus Christ. There was like this 2 year or 2 month period where I like fucking broke writing prompts. I feel like. And I feel like if I kept doing it, I would have like actually popped off a little bit. But I it was mentally draining. So what I would do, right? I found out because I would just post writing prompts for fun. I would just do it here and there.
For those who don't know, would you like to explain what the writing prompts?
Yeah. So there's a subreddit called r/writing prompts where it'll just be you go there and the entire subreddit, all the posts are just prompts. So it'll be like, writing prompt: what if Jesus, Satan, and fucking Santa Claus got their own reality TV show? That's it. That's the whole thing. And the comments are people responding to that. And so what I would do is I noticed that, one, the things that are funny, both the prompts that are funny and the comments that are funny tend to get the most upvotes. And then I noticed that things that were meta or that were like, you know, meme-y, they would also get the most upvotes. And so what I would do is I would go to r/writing prompts. I'd go to Rising. I'd wake up at 8 a.m. and I would start my work. Or I'd start my work at like 8 a.m., like right in the morning. And I would go to the Rising part and I would just look. And so if a post got like 10 to 15 likes with it, because Rising's like Rising within the current hour. If you saw something that got like 10 to 15 likes and it was like posted like 10 minutes ago, you could project that would probably get, like, I don't remember the number. I had the numbers written down. I was, like, really into this. You could project how many likes it would get, and you could sort of see. And so what I realized is that the most important, once you figured out a post was going to blow up, the most important thing to being the most upvoted story on it was being the first one to comment, being the very first person to post a story. And so... I would find like three writing prompts that were like, they were all like, they started to pop off a little bit, and I would go and I would, as quickly as I could, I mean, like, I would bang out a 800 word fucking thing in like 10 minutes. I wouldn't even edit it. I wouldn't even proofread it. I would just go and I'd just get it typed out as quickly as I could, and I'd post it. And then I would like go through and proofread it a little bit afterwards and like edit the post and fuck with it. But I would do that. And then, also by Majinizzi, I would, do that. And then I would do that multiple times. So I would do this about 6 times a day. And it started off like kind of fine. And I would get like 30 upvotes, 50 upvotes. I started getting a few hundred upvotes. Then I started getting to the point where I was routinely getting at least once a day, I'd have a post that was getting 1 to 2,000 upvotes. I was having some that were getting like 7,000, 6,000. And yeah, and so I would about every day I would just grind on it. And I would do this, like, I'd literally post like 6 writing prompts a day, which is like 6 stories a day. Just this, like, banging them out as quick as I could. I had a subreddit with like 600 people in it at one point, and then I never posted it again. And yeah, I was really determined to grind it out, and really like make my own subreddit and like get people reading my writing and stuff. And it was so mentally draining. I feel like if I had the energy and could have done it for like a whole year, I probably could have like built an actual fan base just off of my writing prompts. But it was the worst experience. It was probably the worst time in my writing career. I hated it so much. Because I also wasn't writing stuff I liked that much, because I was trying to just pump it out as quick as possible. I remember one of the last stories I wrote, it was like some writing prompt about Pokemon. And I remember I was writing it and I finished it and I posted it. And then I was like, I'm done. This is the one. I have to take a step back from posting writing prompts. And I haven't really gone back since. And that's the only time I did stuff on Reddit. So, if you go through my Reddit post history, it'll be about 95% that.
I go through Bryce's Reddit history.
Yeah, I'm longhand writer. Anytime you see longhand writer anything, it's typically me.
Would you like to explain why you are longhand writer?
Yeah, because I used to, when I was active on Reddit and when I was posting stuff, I was writing longhand. Not for the writing prompts, because I couldn't. Because I couldn't translate it quick enough. But I used to, there was a point in time, and the only reason I don't do it now, really, is because it takes way too long to transfer everything over to the computer. It's not efficient. But I used to write longhand, which is like with a pencil and paper. So I would actually just like sit down. If I was writing like a novel or something, I would buy composition notebooks. And so I still have composition notebooks that are like book part one, book part two, book part three, because I'd fill up all the composition books. So around that time, I would use the longhand writer as my thing for everything, because I didn't know anyone else that wrote like that consistently. But I don't think, I'm also a lefty, so writing sucks.
Would you, when you were writing in the composition notebooks, did you ever feel a sense of, like, I don't know if safety is the right word, that sounds really lame, but, like...
I know what you mean, because the reason I started, because I had never really written creatively longhand in my life, so I started doing this probably, 2 years into my writing, so I was, 20, because I'd been writing since I was, 17 at that point, writing every day, And so I started writing in the composition notebooks because I was really burnt out, because this is when I used to take no breaks. So I'd write 7 days a week. I had days where I'd write 10,000 words one day, 9,000 the next day, 10,000 the next day. And so it was I was just burnt out. And at this point where I literally could not write anymore, I just burned myself out entirely in writing, and I couldn't figure out what to do. And I was reading a Joe Hill interview. Joe Hill is Stephen King's son, and he was talking about how he had the same thing happen to him after writing Horns, which is one of his novels, where he was struggling and he couldn't get anything down, and Neil Gaiman, the guy that wrote Coraline and American Gods and all that, told him he should try writing longhand, and he said that worked for him. It took away all of the creative inhibitions and the fears and everything, just pulling yourself away from your comfort space and writing in something different. And so, yeah, for me, I feel like my writing is, strangely enough, I feel like I it's always better when I write longhand for a certain point, because I feel like I get tired quicker, but I feel like it takes away a lot of fear. So anytime I have a really bad writing day, or anytime I have a really bad work day, I'll pull out a notebook and I'll just randomly write a story for 30-40 minutes, and it kind of just always straightens me out. I don't know. That's why anytime anyone talks about having a block or anything, the first thing I recommend is whatever you do, do that, but in a different zone. If you're an artist, then you just always draw in CSP, draw by hand. Because I don't know, for me, that is what's always helped the most, has been just taking it somewhere different. So yeah, that's definitely one of the reasons I do it.
I draw in my sketchbook quite frequently. Oops. Almost every day. I used to be every single day. I do a lot of warm-ups in there, but part of the reason I like it is that it feels less like I have less pressure, because I feel like every time I draw something on the computer digitally, I have to show people. If I do a drawing in Photoshop, it's okay, well, I have to post this online, or I have to send it to somebody, or there's an expectation of it, because otherwise I'm just wasting time. But if I'm drawing in my sketchbook, I'm not going to show that to anybody, you know? And that's always something that makes it, I guess, easier for me to get through it.
I also think in general, and this kind of goes hand in hand with what you're saying, I think that for me, it always made it feel like it wasn't work. You and I do this for a living. So we do this every single day, whether we want to or not. There are days where you don't want to do it. You don't want to wake up and write. Or draw. And so for me, I feel like the writing, because it's not how I work, it's not my process. It took me back, even though I didn't write this way when we were writing in high school, writing in a composition notebook makes me feel that same freedom I felt when I was 17 and you and I were making comics and we weren't worrying about showing them to anybody or them being good or anything. it's very reminiscent of that feeling of where I feel like I'm not trying to write to be good. I feel like if I were to try and write a novel again, or if I were to go back to writing novels, I would probably write my next one entirely longhand and then transfer it into the computer. Because I think that it just feels safer.
I do a lot of anytime I have to design stuff, I end up doing it digitally or traditionally for kind of the same way. That's about the only work that I'll ever do traditionally is design stuff, because I feel more like I feel more protected. Like I feel like people aren't going to see it. I never let anybody see my sketchbooks.
That is true. Even when Scott and I were in DC together, he drew across the room, literally like with an arm over it.
Yeah,
I
didn't let Bryce see it. I don't even let my girlfriend see my sketchbooks. It's not because I have anything that I don't want to show. It's just because I like having a safe area that I can draw and people aren't going to see it. It makes me feel like I can actually take risks and draw what I want to draw, without an expectation of like, oh, okay, it has to be good. Like, oh, it doesn't have to be good. I'm the only one that's going to see it. And that's why it helps with designs, because I can try a lot of things and I can make mistakes. And like you know, you can try a design and like, oh, it turned out horrible. Okay, great. It's fine. It's in a sketchbook full of weird stuff.
Yeah, I feel the same way about, because like I said, I have basically every composition book I've ever written in. I don't let anyone look in them. I've never let anybody read anything in them or anything. So I definitely get it. Also, Scrublord said, "Do you guys ever plan on making a comic in the future?" Yeah. I mean that's what Scott and I want to do. We made the Panty Bear, and we've made comics and released comics before the Panty Bear, but the Panty Bear is the first one that we still want to talk about, like that we like enough to still talk about. But yeah, we consider ourselves comic creators, and that's what we want to do. So we're actively writing stuff right now, and like we're always writing. I was going to say, there is never a time where we are not actively plotting or writing a comic. My entire job is just to write and our comics. So it's like what I do whenever I talk about writing in the Discord or anything, I'm talking about writing our comics typically. Unless Scott and I are working on something else, not comic, which we do that from time to time. But typically we're mostly working on comic things. But yeah, I mean our hope in the future is that we can just release comics as regularly as often. Even if it's just comics that Scott and I write, not comics that Scott, like we're doing stuff with, we've talked about Shadia is doing a comic for us right now that Scott and I both wrote. So.
Always writing.
Does the crab have something to do with the comics? No, the crab's just something Scott made up for fun.
And people liked him, so I keep drawing.
Now I gotta change the chat. I also like drawing the crab. Scott, why would you do this?
I don't know what color it's gonna be yet. You might want to wait a minute.
I'm just fucking with you. But yeah, no, definitely more comics coming and actively being worked on. The problem with comics, and this is like the one thing about the industry that I especially wish I knew when I was first starting to work on comics, is just how long it takes to make comics. Not to write them, sometimes to write them, but mostly, like, the book Scott and I are writing right now will probably take Scott 2.5 years to draw. Just being, you know what I mean? So it's like, that's the one thing that sucks about comics. And that's why it's like, I said, we want to be able to work with other people and do as many, because we write a lot of books and we're constantly writing things. So.
One day we're just going to be pumping out 5 books a year.
That's the dream, right? Be fucking getting everything we write drawn immediately. And there's also other things other than just drawing that make comics take a long time.
This is Japanese flag, Lucia.
Rising Sun, Lucia.
Rising Sun, Lucia.
What move did the crab use to beat her?
Choke slam, claw slam.
Damn, that's a good one, Mr. Sacco.
Yeah, Mr. Sacco. But he's yeah. he's you know, he's difficult backstage. That doesn't work for me, brother.
I'm excited. One thing I will say about, I'll just talk about comics a little bit. I am excited when people get to read whatever the next book we're able to release is, because we talked about it before. The Panty Bear was finished being written quite a long time before it was finished being drawn. We wrote it in 2018. So, like, I'm excited for people to be able to see like our more modern writing. Also, buy Scrublord.
Buy Scrublord.
What did you say?
There was a tangent that I had to fix.
I hope you have a good flight.
Tell the pilot I said hi.
Ask if he knows Scott Mallon.
I don't know about this.
I dig it. I like it. I think the white, like the white background's a little harsh.
Well, I didn't really ask what you thought.
Well, I
I really don't care what you think. Fuck you. How about that? That's what I think about what you think.
Yeah, go with the same blue you've gone with 25 times.
That's why I said background, but not blue.
Be original. I'll start a beef with you on stream.
See, Froggy character says it looks, the white looks nice.
I didn't say it looked bad.
You said it looked harsh. I know what that means. We all know what that means.
It just looks a little postcardy right now.
Exactly. Postcards are cool, bro.
Okay.
You ever gotten a postcard? Probably not. People don't like you.
I got a postcard in the mail from Shadia just the other day, first of all. It was very lovely.
Actually, that's true. I did as
well. Yeah. Okay, so how about you shut the fuck up? Stream where we air out our anger. That's basically every stream, though. Trouble in paradise. It ain't paradise over here. I hate him.
I don't like it when mommy and daddy fight.
What's got you think the white's a little too harsh?
I ain't touching the white, fool.
I can't believe this. I've never felt more betrayed in my entire life.
Got him.
We're also going to be streaming on Thursday. You excited to stream twice a week?
Yeah, we'll see how that goes.
I think it'll go fine. I was honestly most nervous about streaming in the middle of the day. As in, I thought it would, I thought I'd be, like, I'd lose a lot more work than I did. But, you know, just write 6,500 words before noon. Just do that.
Just do that. That's too big. I gotta do smaller.
Oh, shit. Yeah, sorry, Veldraws. I forgot. I'll just be dead ass. I forgot to read your message. I was going back to the hip-hop conversation we were talking about earlier, which was what song captures the essence of all of hip-hop, if you can name one song. Veldraws named a few. The Message by Grandmaster Flash. Tricky by Run DMC. That's a good one. Tricky's a really good one. Mama Said Knock You Out by LL Cool J. I Know You Got Soul by Rakim, or Rakim, however you want to say it. Fight the Power by Public Enemy. Enemy. 100 Miles and Running. So Whatcha Sayin' by EPMD. I've never listened to an EPMD song except for that song with Eminem and Nas that came out just a while ago. I'll be 100% honest.
That song called EPMD.
The Night's the Night by Redman. Troy by Pete Rock and CL Smooth. Mass Appeal by Gangstar. The World Is Yours by Nas. And Love by Mos Def. You know, The World Is Yours by Nas might be it. That's definitely one of them.
That's up there
Shook
for sure.
Shook Ones. It's also one of
that's,
them.
That is also...
Shook Ones, I mean, that's definitely up there. Shook Ones is so good.
What are we thinking, guys? What are we thinking about this yellow background versus...
I like it. Oh, so you'll take my feedback when it's good? When it's positive?
Yeah. I hate pretty feedback. Much. That's my thing with anything, is that if somebody compliments me, I assume that they're a genius. And if they don't, I assume that they don't know what they're talking about.
Veldraw said the background's dope. So.
Yeah, well, if Veldraw says it.
Also, yeah, Veldraw, if you want to send more songs, go ahead. Froggy said, do you ever hit a bumpy road, and do you fix it because you depend on the content or because you genuinely love each other?
Our whole relationship is a bumpy road.
Yeah, no, Scott and I have been friends, and people say this all the time, but I like legitimately mean it. We've been friends at this point for so long, because it's been like 12 years at this point, maybe more, I don't fucking know, that we've known each other. We just don't really get into fights or arguments. We definitely get mad at each other. Most recently, I got mad at Scott about an email we had to send. That was about that, but that's about it.
It was kind of silly. Like, it was a silly thing.
That's what I was going to say. Yeah, we'll get mad.
Actually get mad. Yeah, like, it's not a thing that... We never get mad at each other over big things that we're actually really upset
about.
And
we also don't really get mad. Like, what... Okay, so to say, like, what happened was I typed up an email, and I was like, hey, you cool with sending this? And he cut it down a bunch, and I was upset about it. I was like, I had the stuff I wanted to say. I think we should... But, you know, it was whatever. We compromised. I sent the email. It was fine. I was a little annoyed about it for, like, an hour. So I didn't really message him that much. We didn't really talk. He knew I was annoyed. It was fine. And then now we just make jokes about it. That's how we handle it. Now we'll just like make, we'll bring up this email like once a week and we just fucking laugh at it. Like, remember that time we got pissed off about an email? We'll be like, remember that time you fucking cut my email apart? We just do shit like that. Scott and I are not really believers in getting mad or holding grudges, really at anybody, but especially at each other. So we typically, more often than not, we just laugh about things. Also, him and I, we're pretty quick to admit if one of us was being a dick. Like, if he does something and he's a dick about it, he'll typically just, if he could tell, whether he thinks he was in the wrong or not, if he tells it bothers me, he'll just fucking apologize and we'll move on. There's shit like that. I don't know. We've kind of just developed into this. We did when we were younger. We used to get into fights when we were in high school. Like, especially when we were first starting to make comics together, we got into a lot of arguments. We got angry with each other. Here and there.
What is this thing that's sticking out? I think it's a tongue.
I don't know. You just randomly started drawing. I don't know.
Scott, like, I think these are eyes, and like it's like a fish, and this is the tongue.
Okay. Are you just gonna continue this? Just,
maybe. I kind of finished
I feel like it's kind of perfect already, though.
I kind of finished what I was gonna do here.
So here's an interesting question for you, Scott.
I can give her the hard eyes if I want to make it kind of lewd.
Yeah, do the Patreon loot. Joke's on you. I've already seen the Patreon loot.
That's true. It's already done. Sorry, guys.
Isn't she wearing a different colored outfit in the Patreon?
The blue is slightly different. I just decided that I didn't like the blue anymore.
You gotta recolor it.
I'm probably going to go back and fix that.
You crazy son of a bitch. I was joking. But here's a question for you, Scott, that's interesting. It's 3:18 right now. What would you typically be doing in your work day? Like, say you just finished this post sheet, like you just made the same progress. What would you be doing right now at 3:18, having just finished a post sheet? And what all have you done today aside from this post sheet?
Well, I'd still be doing this. I'd still be tinkering with it. I tinker a lot. So, like, typically when you guys see me finish a post sheet on stream, it's not posted for a while, so I spend a lot of time just futzing with it like this. But, like, after I finished this... if I weren't on stream right now, I would probably do... I have one more Patreon post I have to draw for this month. Mm. I would probably draw that. Obviously, I can't do that on stream. Unless I want to get toasted.
Damn.
But,
it took me a minute to get that.
But can't do that on stream. That's probably what I'd be doing. What all I've done today... what did I do today? I penciled a couple of drawings that are going to go up in February. I colored the Patreon version of this post. And that might be it. And I've done this, obviously. I can't remember. I might have done... I think I also did some design work for the story we're working on. But not a ton.
So how much
more... Been kind of a slow day.
Yeah. So typically you would do the lewd you need to do, and would that be the rest of your day? At the end of your day?
It'd probably take me it's not finished, but it's got work done on it. It's already inked, so probably just has like an hour or two left on it. I would say at this point I have about 3 hours of work left in my day. Maybe 2.5 because I'm gonna stop and eat at some point.
Hmm.
What about you? What would you be doing right now if you weren't on stream?
Well, assuming I've had the day I've had today, which so far I woke up at 5:30 and I wrote two scenes for the comic that we're working on. And so I did. I've done, I think, around 6,000 words, I think, today. I just going off memory. So typically, at this point, I would, you know, we started at 2. I would have been probably finished another scene at this point. So probably another 15 to 2,000 words. Or 1,500 to 2,000 words. I would probably be wrapping up writing for the day and starting to do, like the junk work I have, like the random work, like the reading about business stuff that I need to read about for us, or studying stuff, or working on our secret project. Probably I'd probably be doing writing for the secret project, for there. That's what I was doing before we hopped on, because I knew I couldn't write another scene. So I was writing for that. So yeah, I would probably be doing,
remind me later to tell you about a thing about that.
Yeah, the thing you said you were going to tell me, and then you said you didn't want to talk about it right then.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'd probably be doing something like that. If it wasn't for that, I typically, once it gets around 3, when I'm writing a comic, I literally write from about 5 a.m. till about 3, like nonstop. And like I said, typically I'll do about 7 to 8,000 words a day. And so, yeah, typically by this point, I'd be starting to get kind of gassed out. And so I'd be doing easier junk work until about 5. Like I said, researching what we need to research. That's why I do stuff like the overlay that I did, and managing stuff. So yeah, I'd probably do that till about 5, and then typically I clock out at 5 typically every day, because that's when I told my fiance that I would stop working every day, that way I can spend time with her and not work until like 7 o'clock at night. So
I still live alone.
Yeah, I typically stop work at 5 and I eat dinner and hang out with her for a bit.
Pussy.
Yeah. Wow. Oof.
Sorry, gendered slur. But Fly asked how I work so far ahead. It's honestly just from doing comics and having to be on a schedule that I'm so used to being regimented in that way. And it's like, especially the webcomic made it where it's like, you know, okay, you need to have 2 pages a week ready every single week. And so it's like, well, all right, so I can draw 10 pages this week, and then I won't have to draw anything for 5 weeks.
A big part of your job is being able to handle a deadline because of,
yeah,
comics.
That it's a huge thing, so I'm just used to it at this point. And I know that, like, I space out my posts when I think the way I think they'll be the most effective, like when I think it'll, you know, be the best time to post them. I try and post on good days that are good for various reasons. Try not to post on bad days. It's a lot of thought that goes into it. It's probably the biggest thing of what I do. Plus, it, you know, it lets me know that if I work ahead, that just gives me time that I can take off. Whereas if I'm up against the deadline, I have to be doing stuff. And I hate that feeling of having to do something and having to have it done really quickly.
It also, see, one interesting thing about our work day too is also when we're working on a book actively, which is basically always, you and I also have to have multiple meetings throughout the day. Like, legit sit down and talk for, you know, when we're plotting a comic, I would say when Scott and I are plotting a comic, we typically hop on and start talking at like 5:30, and we plot together until like noon. Like, we'll just stay on. We'll go, like, eat lunch at some point and then come back. But typically, yeah, we'll, so, like, that, it's especially different when we're making a comic, because when we're writing a comic, typically it's, like, by noon, we've not done anything but plot. So we finish plotting, and then Scott goes and crams all of his drawing into, like, 5 or 6 hours, and I go have to cram all of my writing into that same time. So that's all. That's always a fun, hectic time when we're plotting something.
Yeah. Hold on, Bryce. Hide my screen temporarily. Okay. While I switch over to something, because I need to. Good. I'm good.
Yep.
Okay. I need to fill some.
We're on Danny.
Airtime. All right, we're good. I'll give you guys a sneak peek of something coming in February.
Wow, is this Bulma?
Yeah, it's Bulma. No, it's Chi-Chi actually.
Oh, okay. Josh the Dreamer said, would you guys be up for doing AU versions of the panty wear?
AU versions? Probably not. If we did anything, it'd probably just be a straight sequel.
What does AU mean?
Alternate universe.
Oh, okay. My brain broke for a second. Yeah, no, if we were to continue the Panty Bear, we'd probably just straight up do a sequel. We were talking about doing a sequel. Well, we talked about it openly too, so it's not like there was a while we were talking about it, but we want to just keep making new things for now. Especially because the Panty Bear wasn't
strongly considered.
Yeah, especially because we didn't write the Panty Bear to be a longer thing, so it would require, I'm not gonna say a lot of work, because I think it's something that's easily, the world allows for us to continue it pretty easily, but it would require making a whole new story, like plotting and coming up with a whole new story, as opposed to you know, so it's just like, if we're gonna do that, we'd rather just write something new.
Not that we'll never do it, but just not right now.
Scott, is Ryuko your favorite Kill la Kill character?
Wrong.
It's, yeah, Mako. There you go. I gave you the right answer.
It's actually Iragami Gori.
I mean, I don't know if you're joking, but
I like how he gets bigger as the series goes on.
Blaze Lumpkin said, I mean, honestly, I wouldn't mind new things. That's the plan. Hopefully we have new things to talk about soon.
That's maybe, that's just waiting on some emails.
I was gonna say, yeah, we're waiting on some emails that hopefully will let us talk about some stuff, but that's the one thing, talking about comics being slow, you also, we can't announce anything because of how slow everything is. It's like, we don't want to announce what we're working on and tell people about it, and then all of a sudden it's like, but 2024.
Damn it, this brush is too small for this, the size of this Lucia.
She's a big Lucia.
It's a big Lucia. Also, my stylus or my pen nib is getting dull. You're so lucky as a writer, you don't have to worry about pen nibs.
Fair.
You have no idea.
But, yeah. How long has it been since you watched Ryuko? Or Ryuko, Kill la Kill?
Since I watched Ryuko. I watched it last year, I think. I rewatched it with my GF because she had never seen it.
What'd she think of
it? So, probably just a year. I think she really liked it. That's her kind of anime. She really liked that. She really liked Panty and Stocking. I think most people that are anime fans like the Trigger stuff and the, you know, like that, yeah, that general vibe.
Trigger especially seems to be very popular with like the Twitter art community and stuff. I feel like maybe it's just because of the style. But I feel like even more so than the actual stories, there's the art. People tend to really dig it.
I mean, I dig it. It's no Darling in the Franxx.
Fucking Darling in the Franxx.
Is that what it's called? Why do I feel like that's not the title?
It is Darling in the Franxx. Because it's a stupid title. What do you mean? You are my darling.
I guess that in my brain, I just thought there's no way that that's actually the title. Joke's on me.
Scott, why do you always draw black fingernails?
I'm incredibly lazy.
Wowzers.
For somebody that works as much as I do, I'm very lazy.
Well, I don't think it's actually laziness. I think it's because of the comics mentality, right? You have to draw stuff again and again and again. So it's, when you're creating characters or when you're doing anything, you're typically thinking about the fact that you have to draw it again and again. It's like the thing we always joke about, how like Scar from FMA, he has all these really intricate, cool tattoos. but then he wears a jacket the whole time. And it's just so that she didn't have to keep drawing the tattoos. And I think the same thing goes with you.
This is something that everybody actually should learn. It doesn't matter if you're doing a comic or not. It's actually more important for animation, but comics it's really important. But it goes for everybody, except for video games, I guess. Draw your OC where you can draw them repeatedly, and don't do what some beginner artists do and put 1,000 zippers and bells and whistles and
don't square
it, make it completely unrepeatable. You know, like giving them braided hair. Make it where you can repeat it.
Yeah, you at this point, you can literally bang out like an actual quality Lucio, like in like minutes, can't you? Like a full pose.
Oh yeah.
So it's like, but I feel like that's because with comic, especially, you have to think about it, because when you're drawing a comic, you're not only having to draw a character hundreds of times, you're having to draw them in different poses hundreds of times, with other characters in front of them hundreds of times, backgrounds behind them hundreds of times. So like, doing that one thing to make your job easier in making the main characters or the characters that are going to be drawn a lot really easy to draw and quick and efficient, it just speeds everything else up.
That's why you should go look at Akira Toriyama and how easy it is to draw Goku for him. There's no intricate hair design.
I've learned about Scott is that if you ask him any question about art, it'll always come back to study Akira Toriyama.
That's basically it. If you want to know how I do anything or why I'm able to do any of the things that I do, usually it's because I studied Akira Toriyama.
I mean, it's fair. I feel like he doesn't get enough credit in the art world. Like, as an artist, I mean. I feel like Dragon Ball is just thought of, you know, Dragon Ball, it's fun. Maybe it's because more people are nostalgic or watched the anime specifically rather than reading the manga.
I think part of it is that what makes his artwork so so unbelievably impressive isn't stuff that really catches the eye of most people, like non-artists. I would say within art, he's very well respected and he gets the credit he deserves. But like, if you ask the, you know, the, like a normal person, just like, who's the best mangaka? Most of them probably won't say Toriyama. And maybe he's not the best, but he deserves to be in that conversation, in my opinion.
Aww.
Because like, you know, stuff like how great a character design is, or
his character is nutty.
Like stuff like how well he's able to use ink and render lighting with only two tones and stuff like that. Like, that's just not stuff that pops out to most people. You get artists to look at it like me and just nerd the fuck out and like, man, how do you do that? But
Akira Toriyama and Dragon Ball in general was what got me into art as an adult. Before I was making comics or anything, I remember Scott got me to start watching anime. And I just never really got the whole, like, oh, this anime has great animation. Oh, it's beautiful. I never cared about that until I watched, and I'm not saying Dragon Ball Z has great animation or anything, but I watched Dragon Ball, and I remember seeing the painted backgrounds, and I was so, like, uninto anime at the time that it was the first time I'd seen painted backgrounds in an anime, and, like actual, like, hand-drawn animation, and I remember it legitimately, like, it sucked me in. I remember messaging Scott about it, like, freaking out.
1063 says, I wonder if that's why he stopped drawing Launch. He stopped drawing Launch because he forgot about Launch.
That is true. To be fair, though, she's so irrelevant even in Dragon Ball, like in the original Dragon Ball.
That's true. I need to change my pen nib, so if I'm not drawing for a minute, that is why.
Wow.
It got so dull all of a sudden. I just changed it a couple of weeks ago, but...
We draw too much.
Apparently.
We do too much work. Yeah, I was amazed when I read, because I grew up watching, I watched Dragon Ball Z a lot, like in high school and stuff, but when I read Dragon Ball and Dragon Ball Z fully through for the first time, which was just like 3 or 4 years ago, when I read the manga, I was amazed by how, for one, consistent the artwork is throughout, but just by how, like, I don't know, like how good It was. I don't know how else to describe it. Like, a lot of the paneling's really smartly done. A lot of the lettering is really well done. I remember you really gushed about his lettering for a while there when you were trying to get better at it.
That's where I learned how to do most of my lettering. Also, I need to pee, so can you entertain people for like
I got it. Go
two
ahead.
Minutes?
Go ahead. Empty your bladder.
Tell a story.
And this is the Bryce Show now, everybody. What's up? It's your boy. But yeah, I remember I was reading Dragon Ball and Dragon Ball Z to study comics and stuff. Specifically, I was trying to study because there was a time period where I was trying to get better at pacing with comics. So I was trying to figure out how to make a comic move faster. I actually specifically remember a good friend of ours, Julian. He writes a comic called Aftersight that Scott draws. I was reading his comic, and there was a part where it's like Dez, the main character, wakes up, and then she's at a bus stop, and then she's at work, then she does this, and like everything moved so fast. And I remember thinking about my writing, and I was like, if I were to write this exact same scene, I would write it in like steps. So it'd be like she wakes up, she's getting out of bed, she's getting dressed, she's at the bus stop, she's getting on the bus, she's waving hi to the bus. And I remember, like, it was a big realization how much better it read just to be snappier and just get through the junk. Because I used to be really, like, trying to make every moment perfect. So really trying to... It's because I read a lot of novels, I feel like. And so I took... It was one thing I took into comics that I didn't want to take into my comics. And so I was reading Dragon Ball and Dragon Ball Z to get better at that, because Toriyama keeps things moving at a good pace, I feel like. I'm talking specifically in the moment-to-moment details, like literally from like the down to panel to panel, not like arc to arc or anything, or like storyline to storyline. And I remember getting like dead ass just like re-engrossed in this story I'd already watched and seen 100 times because of just how fucking good it was. Chainsaw Man pacing, that's exactly what I'm talking about. When I read Chainsaw Man, I had the same thing. I read that and thought about it a lot too, and studied Chainsaw Man a lot too. Gelatin Boy, shut up, Scott. Gelatin Boy, this is my stream now, motherfucker. You're Gonzo. Gelatin Boy said, in my opinion, fast dialogue has me go back about to see what happened because I lose the plot faster if it goes faster. That is true. When I'm see, because I feel like it's a thing that a lot of people do, and oh no, I didn't say you shut up. I said Scott shut up. I apologize if it came off like I said that. No, I'm being rude to Scott. I lost my train of thought now. But I think the thing is, like, it's finding a way to keep things fast paced, but only when they need to be, right? So it's like, if you have to go back and reread it, or you have to like, you lose train of thought, I feel like a lot of times that means they did it in the wrong spot, because it shouldn't be done in spots where you need to pick up information or where you need to be. It's just getting through. You know, the thing they don't tell you about storytelling and about writing books is that sometimes you gotta write something that just isn't the most entertaining thing because the story needs it. Sometimes you gotta write somebody fucking getting on the bus, walking home from work. You know what I mean? And the way you do it, or the way it's like easiest to do it, is to get through it. You just get through that shit. You just get it done and out. People don't remember something if it's one or two panels. People do remember something if it's one or two pages. That's like a big lesson I've learned. So the stuff that goes over a page or even over a panel, you want to be something that the reader is supposed to remember or is supposed to intake. The stuff that's just like one panel, like now they're here, now they're here, now they're here. That stuff you are actively telling the reader, skim through it. Because you know what I mean? Because you're like, I don't care about this. Or I want you to get through this quickly. Or even in general, it's stuff the readers are going to skim through no matter what. I've learned through my own reading and through talking to people and through my own writing, people will start to naturally skim at some points with anything, whether it's really good or really bad. And they'll do it because they'll pick the parts that are downtime in their brain. So they'll see like, oh, someone's getting on the bus. Or they'll like have just read a really... It's kind of like pro wrestling, right? It's kind of like pro wrestling. But I think about pro wrestling a lot when it comes to writing, because pro wrestling, it's all about what you call like the heat of the match or the build of the match. And so, but it's like that throughout the entire show. So if you have a really, really good match to open the show, like your first match on your show is like a 5-star fantastic wrestling match. The next match It could be even better, but people will not care because they've already tuned out because of what they've just watched was so good. They need to cool down. For example, in MMA, there was a card earlier this year where there was one of the greatest fights I've ever seen, Justin Gaethje versus Michael Chandler to open the show. We were all losing our mind, going insane. In the next fight, there were the most strikes ever thrown in a UFC fight, if I'm going off memory correctly. And the crowd, and me and Scott, did not give a fuck. We could not care. It was a great fight, too. But it just didn't... It loses that. And I think books and everything like that are the same way. Whereas when you read a really high impact moment, the reader's going to go and cool down after it, you know? And so you have to think about that a lot. You have to think about that cool down period. And yeah, so that's my end of my thing. Also, Rubber Century, it was me that got COVID and it sucked. It was not fun. You can hear I'm still coughing because of it. I played a voice clip earlier of how I sounded during it. It was not good. And you're right, the DMV, everyone in Maryland, it seems like, is getting COVID. Everyone.
Also, hey, Rubber Sentry.
That is true. Rubber Sentry, the GOAT, one of the OGs. One of the stream OGs. We have OGs with everything that we do. He's one of the stream OGs.
Not a Discord OG.
That is true. Yet. Rubber Sentry, yeah. Can we make a sub goal for you to join the Discord, Rubber Sentry? Would you allow that if we have a sub goal, like 100 subs, Rubber Century joins the Discord?
Yeah, I can't think of anything.
You turn
20,
that's cool, but answer my question. We can get personal after you join the Discord. Until you join the Discord, I'm not going to let you just... You need to wine and dine me, Rubber. Come on. I'm being ignored. I'm being actively ignored. Happy birthday, Rubber. Happy late birthday.
Can you believe that?
Can you believe that? Thankfully, Blaze Lumpkin, I am feeling better now. I'm feeling much better than I felt last week. Last week, I was dealing with fevers and coughing and yada, yada, yada. So I'm feeling much, much better now. I've been able to work, which means I'm feeling better. Yeah, do that.
That's an artistic choice right there. That's what we call that.
Bill Draws hit us with some more... hip-hop question or things. Cream by Wu-Tang, Rapper's Delight. Shut the fuck up when I am speaking, mister. Rapper's Delight by Sugar Hill Gang, Got You All in Check by Busta Rhymes, Delight by Common, MC's Act Like They Don't Know, Sound of the Police by KRS, Shook Ones. Today was a good day. That's another one. Today was a good day by Ice Cube, talking about the essence of hip-hop. Just a Friend by Biz Markie, Ain't No Half Step by Kane, Unity by Latifah, I Know Me, Myself, and I by De La, Dead Presidents 2 by Jay-Z, that's good. Juicy by Biggie, that's good. Fight For Your Right by the Beastie Boys, that's also good. Jayami said, is anyone getting an extra dose or are y'all just getting a booster? I was supposed to get my booster, and I got COVID.
You got a booster, alright.
I was going to say, and so now I got to wait until I'm done my quarantine to get my fucking booster. And then I'll get sick from the fucking booster too. This shit's bullshit. I think that's why I got so sick though, because I like my booster period's here. Because I think I got Omicron. Because I didn't get as sick as I think I would have if I would have gotten normal. Have you heard about Deltacron? I saw that the other day. The Delta Omicron thing.
No.
Yeah, it's like I think it was Cyprus. They found one that combines Omicron and Delta.
That sounds about right. Also, Veldraws is a hip-hop
that is true
coming in here.
Veldraws, we gotta talk more with you about hip-hop.
Are you excited for Corday's album?
Scott Veldraws? And I don't meet a lot of people that like old school hip-hop, really. Everyone we like is like, bro, yeah, I like Cardi B. Not Cardi
two
B.
Two questions, Veldraws.
Playboy Cardi.
What are your... Three questions, actually. Maybe just two, because I forgot one. Two questions. One... What are your thoughts on
you
Playboy
Cardi?
You do
need to listen to Corday, first of all. Go, when you're done this stream, go listen to The Lost Boy. I guarantee you will love it. Knowing the kind of music you like and what you've talked about, it's so good. And his new album comes out Friday, so it's the perfect time. You should listen to it. Go listen to R&P with him and Anderson .Paak, and that will tell you whether you want to listen to that album right now. It is so good. I am such a simp for Corday and for this album. I'm trying to get everyone on this train. Go listen. Rubber Century gets it, man. Corday is the shit. Wintertime's great. Every song on The Lost Boy is really fucking good. It's like great. It's soulful. Fucking, it's a good album. Sorry.
Maybe it's a Maryland thing. Maybe. Anyways, Veldraws, what are your opinions on Playboi Carti? And two, what are your opinions on modern Eminem, if I've not asked you that already?
You said you had three questions.
Yeah, and I forgot one of them, so I moved to the two.
That song with Pusha T on Cordae's album? Come on. I forgot what it's called right now off the top of my head.
I love that song that I don't know
what it's called. Lost and
Found? Family Matters is the best, no cap.
Family Matters is a really good song. That's the one with, is that the one with Aaron Ray featured on it? Or am I thinking of a different song? It's been a long time. Or not a long time. It's been like, I get fucking track names mixed up in my head. Modern Eminem is always a fun topic because that's when you bring out the anger in people, is when you start talking about whether you like modern Eminem or not. So Scott, what's your take on modern Eminem?
Pretty good.
Yeah. Here's the thing. Revival's ass. Revival is garbage, dumpster fire music. It's really bad. And I say this as a really big Eminem fan. Kamikaze's really good. Kamikaze, if you get rid of a few songs on it, it's a pretty good album. You get rid of the Venom song. You get rid of Stepping Stone, which is one of the worst songs in this career. It's great the first time you listen to it. It's a cool thing, D12, yada yada. Fucking, there's this disgusting flow thing at the end that I hate. I don't like the beat in that song either. Both Music to Be Murdered By's I like a lot. I think, because here's the thing about music. Here's my one complaint about Music to Be Murdered By. I'm just counting both of them as one thing. So Eminem came up in like the early 2000s, obviously. And in that era, because you were selling CDs, you'd put like 20 fucking songs on an album, right? And Eminem still has that mindset now. That mindset's died a little bit with streaming. Now we're getting a lot more 10-song albums or even less or just a little bit more. But Eminem still does that. And the problem with it is, like, I feel like if you took the first Music to Be Murdered By and cut, like, 6 songs off it... Yeah, I already know you linked FAQ, Robert Sentry. I'm not even going to click that link, and I know it's FAQ. But if you cut, like, 5 or 6 songs off of Music to Be Murdered By... I see you said him and Kid Cudi. I was wrong. If you cut, like, a few songs off it, it's such a better album. Like, it's so much better. And that's the same thing. That's kind of how the second one is, too. I just feel like if he cut some of the filler junk off his albums, if he cut the stupid fucking love songs, and he just cut some of the more junky stuff, they'd be like, they could like legitimately be really good albums. Because there's a great 10-man run in or a 10-song run in both of those albums.
There's also this weird thing where he's reached I don't know really when it happened. I don't know if it happened with like Recovery or if it happened before or after Recovery or exactly when it happened. He reached some point where it became like the thing to hate on his shit. You know what I mean? And I think especially like a lot for Recovery. Younger people that didn't listen to his older stuff when it came out. That like try and pretend like he was never, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Even if you don't like his new stuff, I mean, his old shit.
You can't
like,
deny that the Eminem show is a fucking classic. Like, you cannot.
It's like hip hop caviar. Can.
If you say you don't like the Eminem show, I don't know how you say you like hip hop. That album is so good. I'm not gonna say it's the greatest. It's my personal favorite album of all time. Either that or Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy. But I'm not gonna say it's the best album of all time. But like, it's great hip hop. Same with the Marshall Mathers LP. I get not liking the Slim Shady. I get that being too weird. I get not liking Relapse because the accent. I definitely get not liking Recovery because Recovery's not good. But I same with like, you can say you hate Modern Eminem. How do you not like the Marshall Mathers LP too? That album's great. It's a good album. It has some misses on it, but it's by no means bad.
What's the one song Stronger Than I Was?
That song's a miss. Same with the song with Skylar Grey on that album. Asshole, I hate that song too.
I don't mind that one so much.
But see,
tangent.
But that's like, that's my biggest problem, I think, is people acting like M was never good or like he's not important to hip hop at all. When it's like, I said, I don't know how, it's like, I don't, if anyone says they don't like Eminem, I would just hand him the Eminem show. And I would say, if you like hip hop, how do you not like that? You can not like it. How do you think it's actively bad? You know what I mean? That's like the weird thing to me. Like, the beats are great on it. Business is like one of the greatest hip hop songs ever recorded. Like, am I crazy? Business is fantastic. Yeah, the flow on that song, the like G funky beat, it's crazy. I don't know. That's just my take. Represent said you gotta step back and look at the industry for what it is now instead of what it was. I do agree with that. I think the Eminem's biggest problem, if I'm being honest, is I think that he, because he comes from the battle rapper age, has hit some point now where he really only cares about lyrics and about just being fucking crazy with them. Like, Revival's ass, it's not good. But if you actually read the lyrics, I'm not saying the bars are good, but like the actual structure of the lyrics and like all the double entendres and all the flows and all, like, Scott can talk more about this because Scott knows more about the actual like breaking down like rap bar by bar. But like, it's crazy, even on Revival, which is like really bad. But I think he's hit this point where he cares more about that almost than he does making sonically good music.
Oh, for sure. He did that song that we actually mentioned earlier, the EPMD2 song, is a really good example of that, because like he's on a track with Nas and EPMD, and it's like he clearly went to that track with the intention of, I need to prove that I am as good or better than these guys that I'm rapping with. And like, technically, if you just like take the sonic aspect out of it, his verse is like off the fucking charts lyrically. It just doesn't sound as good as like EPMD's 8-bar verse or Nas's like 16 or 24, I can't remember. That's like just real smooth and just kind of flows with it. It's like sometimes less is more, but he always goes way overboard with it.
Also, Veldraws answered the question. He said, Playboy Cardi is cool, but not my cup of tea. And modern Eminem's a trip. He's far more lyrically capable than ever, but his catalog's not even close to his old album. I would agree. Yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
I've not really listened to Playboy Cardi, but I mean, like, I get why people like him. It's just kind of a meme, I feel like, though. Like, Playboy Cardi. Because his fans act like he's fucking... Yes, from Century just said they geek me. Yeah, his fans act like he's the second coming of fucking Biggie. I feel like it's really weird.
But I can't tell if they're serious.
That's
or not.
The thing. I don't know if they're actually memeing or if they're being serious.
Like, there was the meme that Playboy Cardi invented music. And like, I know that's a joke, but I really can't tell where he stands with his fans.
I also don't know if that's something he said. Like, part of me thinks that could be a Playboy Cardi thing that he said. Like, I don't know. Yeah, it's weird.
But also, about him, like, comparing his old catalog, it's also, like, you gotta think, that's gotta be unfair, right? Is, like, anytime you release any music, the thing that you get compared to is the Marshall Mathers LP and the Eminem Show.
Yeah, it's
like, that's
weird.
Like, that's the bar that you have to reach.
It's weird. You and I talked about this before, about, like, you and I once had a conversation. We were actually talking about Eminem, I think, and we were talking about how scary it's gotta be to write your best thing ever, and then, like, he might never write anything. He probably won't ever write anything or make anything as good as the Eminem Show again. And at some point, he had to accept that and just keep making music. But people didn't, because we were talking about Stephen King, I remember. And we were like, you know, he wrote like The Shining, Misery, all these books that are considered like the greatest horror books of all time. And it's like, how does he keep just writing? Like, how has he written like 70 novels since then? You know what I mean? And it's like, because he's always held to the same standards. And I think it's a bit unfair, because it's kind of the thing of like, I don't know. It's just, he did what he did, but I feel like, I don't know. At some point for me, I realized I was disliking stuff just because I was comparing it to an artist's old work. And it's not just with Eminem, it's with other people too. Rather than actually taking the music for what it was. And I feel like that's kind of a problem, or kind of a bad thing. Like, it sucks when you are so attached to the old music that it being a little bit worse makes it a lot worse to you. Because, like I said, like, I feel like there were albums that I legitimately should have liked that it took me a long time to like, just because I was like, well, this isn't as good as fucking, you know. Like, Nas fans be crying right now because of how many bad albums he's released and good albums he's released. You know what I mean? Like, and I say that as
Nas
someone...
Nas is another one. He's on a crazy run recently. You still not listened to his new EP?
I've not listened to the Magic one, no. I've listened to Kings of These Two, but I haven't listened to Magic. It's called Magic, right?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, I haven't listened to that because I wasn't fucking expecting it. I was just sitting there one night, and then it's like, I was like, a fucking Nas drop? What?
Yeah, he dropped on Christmas Eve, I think.
Yeah, I like, so I just haven't gotten to, I haven't gotten to listen to it. Veldrell said, how do you dunk on Slim Shady's LP and Marshmello's LP, but cite Low End Theory or Illmatic as the peak of music? You can't cherry pick that shit. Nas also hit the same roadblock, but that's where the public image thing comes in.
Yeah, I'll also say that part of it with him is that he has a very combative personality or public image. And sometimes when you do that, you invite more criticism than maybe somebody who doesn't take himself very seriously.
I think he also hurts himself by pretending that he's not fucked up. Like, he still talks about Revival like we're dumb. Like,
yeah.
Like,
which is weird, because in the past, like, when he released Encore and it was bad, and then Relapse, which people didn't like.
He shits on Relapse all the time. Like,
yeah, but then he like, but when it comes to Revival, he's like, no, fuck you guys, you're wrong.
Well, I think it's because we talked about it, right? The lyrics thing. I think that when he made Revival, he spent 4 years between the Marshall Mathers LP 2 and Revival. I don't know if he was working on that whole time. I don't think he was. But I think he just let it in the oven for too long and was just too heavy on it, just thinking about it too much. Also, Rubber Century said, last album I listened to from Joey Badass was All American Badass. That's also the last album I listened to from Joey Badass. That album's incredible. All American Badass is a really good album. Would recommend it to anyone who wants to listen to it. It's a really good. I really like Joey Badass, but I'm not listening to his new stuff. I don't know why. Same thing like you said, Rubber Century. I don't know why I have it. I'm only just now remembering that I have it. But yeah, I'm excited for that Corday album this week. Has a song with Stevie Wonder on it?
There a Stevie Wonder, and who else is on it?
There's another one, right? Stevie Wonder, Nas, and Freddie Gibbs, I think, yeah. All in one song. It's like it's fucking crazy. Like, bro, Corday is fucking snapping. Yeah, and Eminem, he has a feature on it. He's being on the remix of The Parables, which I think he's going to kill that beat. So
either that or rap about sheep having sex with shepherds and stuff. There's no in between.
Fuck what you heard. Yeah, feature Eminem is a whole different beast. Feature Eminem, I feel like he's just been on a bit of a downturn with features.
Well, it's either he drops like the Friday Night Cypher verse or the Lord Above verse, and you're like, holy shit, he just slaughtered everybody on this track. Or he releases like Rainy Days and he talks about shepherds having sex with their sheep, and you're like,
He also does this thing when he features. Eminem, I'm talking to you real quick. He changes the beat every time he's featured. He just changes the beat. He literally just does beat switches every time. It's so consistent that it makes me think it's a him decision. He gets the beat and he's like, I don't like your beat. I'm good. You know, when Royce recently talked about how M actually didn't like the Friday Night Cypher beat, but he hopped on it out of respect for Sean or whatever, I get it. Because I bet he would have fucking changed the beat for himself if he had the opportunity.
Your beat's good, but let me show you how I can rap fast.
And the worst part is, I'm not the shit on Eminem. Eminem doesn't always have the greatest beats. I'll be honest. I mean, like, you know, when he doesn't have Dre behind him, his beats can be hit or miss. I know Echo has told me that he doesn't like Eminem's beats much at all. What is that?
We've spent most of the stream talking about like wrestling and hip hop, and our viewers have been pretty consistent. The day streams are fucking lit. When apparently
there's
nobody else streaming.
We're only
going to
be streaming during the day now.
Yeah, 2 p.m. streams are awesome.
It's actually just Toast got toasted. That's why all of his fans are here.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we sniped those fucking Toast fans. Oh no, I messed up the design. Oh god. Oh, I drew the wrong glove. Fuck it, deleting the
Calm
drawing.
Down is just a crazy song in general, to be fair. Both him and M kill it. I don't know if you've ever seen the interview where Busta talks about that, and he's like, yeah, so like he was only supposed to send me, I forget how many bars it was, Scott, what was it? It's like, he was only supposed to, there you go.
It was like, he sent M the thing, and he had like Busta had like a 32 bar verse. And he was like, hey, M, like, do a 32 bar thing or whatever, or like even 16, just like send something in. And M sent in like 48, and then so Busta re-recorded his stuff and added like 16 more bars to it, and they went back and forth like 3 or 4 times, and it delayed Busta's album by like an extra year because he kept adding extra stuff, and then M kept adding extra stuff. They just kept going back and forth.
That's why
and
the
song ended
like
up being
minutes.
Like 6 minutes.
Yeah. Yeah, it that song's fucking crazy. I always forget how much I like that song. That's great because that's one of those things that song might not sonically be that great, but man, is it just two dudes fucking rapping. You know what I mean? It's just two dudes fucking going, just spitting. I love it, man. I fucking love it. I'm a big fan. I like choruses and catchy stuff, but there's just something about someone just rapping for like 5 minutes.
It's just old school hip hop.
That's why I like the first song on Kamikaze, The Ringer. The reason I like The Ringer so much, it's just 5 minutes, 4 minutes, whatever, of just Eminem's rap. It's great. I love it. I don't know. I just, I like it. I feel like it forced it to be more creative. I kind of hate when it's like short verse, chorus.
How you going to do Playboy Cardi like that on stream?
I'm sorry. I'm really coming at Cardi. Echo said, so anyways, Kanye West. There we go. I think I'd mentioned Kanye. I mentioned Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy.
Yeah, that counts. We're in the middle of our second Kanye streak.
That is true. Yeah, we lost one, unfortunately. It's okay, though. Eventually, Kanye will hear about the Kanye streaks. And then we'll be really famous.
Get Kanye on stream.
I don't think having Kanye on stream would be a very good thing.
I think it would be good for our viewership.
It probably would be for our viewership, but
coming on our stream would be just weird enough for Kanye to do it.
I could see Kanye popping up on some small, like 50 person stream, just casually one day, and like not even acting like it's a big deal.
We'll just tell him Kim's gonna be here. Did that just kill our chance of getting Kanye?
Rubber Century said, so about that Lil Wayne, how do we feel about the Carter 5? I'll be honest, I've never really liked the Lil Wayne album when I've listened to it. I've liked him on features. Feature Wayne's crazy. And I really like Lil Wayne as a rapper. I think he's very talented. But I've just, for whatever reason, not liked his albums that much when I've tried to listen to them. They've always like sounded kind of like 2003 and gross. Like I don't know why. I know it's just a me thing.
People told I really me to like to Carter 3.
People told me to listen to his mixtapes too, and I tried that, and it didn't click with me. I think I listened to Carter 2. Like that's the only one I think I fully listened. The one with Fireman on. Is that Carter 2? Fireman's a banger.
Can't remember. Yeah, I like Carter 3 a lot.
Maybe I'll have to go.
But I'm not the biggest Wayne fan.
I don't know what Carter, like which one Carter 5 is. I know I wouldn't have listened to it. Is that the one with Mona Lisa on it though? Mona Lisa goes hard. Crazy. Mona Lisa's a great song. Yeah, Mona Lisa, him and Kendrick, that's like one of my favorite storytelling rap songs. It's so good. I don't know. Wayne is one of those dudes that like his lyrics are so crazy. Like, cause he just like, they're not like fancy or anything. They just like, I don't know. It literally just feels like a dude talking. You know what I mean? I like it. It's different. Veldraw says Drake opinions. Don't like Drake. Not a very big Drake fan.
Drake is just corn.
I feel like it's like kind of the thing to shit on Drake, but I've tried listening to multiple Drake albums. I don't know. It doesn't click with me.
Here's my thoughts on Drake. I've listened to some Drake things that I've thought like, and like there have been moments when I'm listening to them where I'm like, okay, this is actually like pretty good. I fuck with this. And any time that I've thought that about a Drake song, I is almost immediately every single time been followed up with like the corniest shit I've ever heard in my life. And that's what I think about Drake.
Like a light. That's what we always make fun of. Yeah, I'll be honest with Drake, and maybe this is different on like his earliest shit. I feel like it's definitely fair to say now though. With any kind of music, but especially hip hop, because it is somebody's voice specifically that you are hearing. Like it's very, the lyrics and the words are very important. I feel like his music feels very disgenuine to me, or ingenuine. Like it feels very, I don't want to say corporate-y. Maybe that's the right answer, but it just, I don't know. It doesn't really feel, it doesn't hit. It doesn't feel very genuine. I don't feel like Drake is saying the things or has the opinions that he says most of the time.
Ghostwriter.
Yeah, and everyone's saying listen to the old Drake. Because that's the thing, right? Like, I think he can rap. Like, I think he's a talented guy. I mean, he's a mega millionaire. He gotta be fucking talented to do what he's done. It's like, I'm not taking that away from him.
Like I said, there's just...
Kid every Rock's time early works cast a long shadow.
Yeah, no, every time I listen to something, I like something with Drake, he does something to make me not like it. Plus, he got bodied by Pusha T, so.
He got bodied by Pusha T, man. Bodied. That's got to be one of the most one-sided feuds, I feel. That feud got ended with a diss. Like, literally a diss got dropped, and there was no coming back for Drake. Story of a D-Down is one of the hardest fucking disses of all time. Even use the story of OJ beat for it. Speaking of story of OJ, what do we all think of 444? It's been a while since that came out. What, 4 or 5 years? 6 years? How long has it been?
It came out about the same time the last Kendrick album came out.
2017? Jesus.
Yeah.
444 is a good album.
It's very good.
It's a good album. Gloria is one of my favorite Jay-Z songs. I really like that song. The one all about like his
mom.
It
took me maybe a year and a half to get Bryce to listen to that.
That album is true, because you couldn't listen to it or anything because it was only on a bullshit Tidal.
That's true. It was on Tidal.
And I wasn't going to fucking listen to it on Tidal. Anyway.
Tell me how you really feel about Tidal.
Fuck Tidal. All my homies hate Tidal. I'm glad Jay-Z moved the fuck on. Also, Athenian, the GOAT. Hello.
Hello.
But, yeah, what would you say is your favorite Jay-Z album, Scott? Has a lot of good ones. Especially
either the Black Album or Reasonable Doubt.
I've not listened. Is Reasonable Doubt his first one? I have listened to Reasonable Doubt.
Yeah.
Yeah, Reasonable Doubt's really good.
That album's phenomenal.
Mine's the Black Album. The Black Album's so fucking good, man. The Black Album is one of those few albums where the singles on it are actually incredible. You know what I mean? Like, I've heard 99 Problems and Dirt Off Your Shoulder and all. Dirt Off Your Shoulder's on that album, right?
I think yes.
I've heard those songs so many times, and they still fucking slap. They are still crazy. Tyler, the Creator? Yeah, Tyler's good. Call Me If You Get Lost is one of the best albums of last year. And I say that as not a very big Tyler fan. I've never really been much of a Tyler. I didn't like his early stuff that much. I'm not going to say I thought it was corny, but I just never found it funny.
I thought it was corny.
Okay, yeah, I thought it was corny. I'll be honest, yeah, I thought it was corny. I wasn't ever really a big fan of it. Igor was weird. It's weird.
Igor was weird. It was not my cup of tea, but I could understand why people would like it.
Flower Boy? Is that what the one before Igor's called? I liked Flower Boy. I thought Flower Boy was good. I didn't think it was crazy.
It was good. It was a good album.
I thought it was a good song. Call Me If You Get Lost is great. That's good. Also, DJ Drama yelling in the background has grown on me the more I listen to it. I'll be honest, I was really against just DJ Drama constantly yelling.
But he does yell a lot.
It's kind of grown on me. I kind of dig it now. I kind of like. I feel like it adds to the end. Corso, crazy song.
That might be the best single of the year.
Yeah, Corso's great, man. That whole album's so fucking good. If you like hip hop, you deserve it to yourself to listen to the Tyler album. Tyler brings some crazy energy. That's one thing I will say. He always, he brings just great energy.
He was also featured on The Weeknd's album.
He was. The Weeknd's album's pretty good. I like the new Weeknd album. I don't know if anyone else listened to it. I thought it was weird. I thought it was funky. Had a very
I thought it was all right.
I thought it... Well, you also tend to not like that kind of pop.
It's definitely not my kind of music.
I was going to say, yeah. It's much more... I tend to like more poppy things like that more than you do. But I... yeah, I liked it. What the fuck's that? Take My Breath Away? Take My Breath? That song is fucking fantastic. That song and... it's like one of the last songs on the album. I forget the name of it. Like literally the second to last album or song is like the... It's so... They're so good. Yeah, that. But I'm also... I like The Weeknd.
I don't dislike him.
I think you fucking hate him. I know you do. Shut your mouth.
I'm sure he's a nice guy.
I hear you talk shit about Abel all the time, Scott.
It's true. I have a Discord server specifically for trash talking The Weeknd.
you only call him Abel. Less than zero. That, yeah, less than zero. That, if that's not one of like the biggest hits of the beginning of the year, it's crazy. That song is so fucking catchy. Echo, what do you think of it? Did you listen to the album? I feel like that's something you would like. I feel like you would like that, the new Weeknd album.
I think that his status on Discord was about how good it was for a couple of days. It might still be, I don't know.
Yeah, it's really good. Veldraw said, speaking of Tyler, only Lucifer related, I miss Doom. Yeah. I've never listened to a Doom album, though, I'll be honest. Like, really? A full album. Yeah, I've never done it. I'll be honest, until he passed away, I hadn't really listened to much of him at all. Because I feel like Doom is weird, because he's like your favorite rapper's favorite rapper, but I feel like he's not as popular. He's a lot more popular now, I feel like, than he was for a long time.
That might be fair.
I know Food. That's the one everyone recommends to me. You can listen to the Corday. Veldros, before the next stream, before Thursday, you listen to the Corday album. I'll listen to the MF Doom album. I'll make that with you.
Give me homework, Veldros. I've already heard that album.
Go listen to Yeezus.
I've already listened many times,
listen
actually.
Listen to Yeezus until it's your favorite Kanye album. Burn on sight into your brain.
When I finish this pose, you want to wrap up the stream?
Yeah, we can.
Probably take me a couple minutes. I still feel pretty good, but I don't want to burn all my stream energy before
before Thursday. I was going to say that, though, about the early stream. I feel like I could stream a lot longer, like right now, than I normally could. Like, normally by this point, we hit 2 hours and I'm exhausted. To be fair, we also aren't doing this after we've done like 10 hours of work.
That's true. Only how many? 7 or 9 hours of work? 8 hours of work?
Veldraws gave you an assignment. Athenian, I'm sorry. We every Tuesday at 2 p.m. EST, and every Thursday at 5 or 6 p.m. We haven't decided the time yet. Anyone listen? But one of our goals, I'll say this, is to be going live at the times we say. So, like, we are going to be trying to go live at 2 p.m. every Tuesday. And either 5 or 6, we don't know specifically what it'll be yet. But every single Thursday, we'll be going live. I've not listened to Gunna's new album. I've not listened to any Gunna album. I'll be 100%.
I can't believe that Veldraws is still trying to pimp out Common to me.
I've never listened to a Common album either. I'll be honest, Veldraws, until you, I had never met anyone that like really was fucking pumped about. I wish I was excited about Common as you were about anything. I gotta hop on the train. Did you listen to the new Gunna album, Scott?
No.
What's the last album you listened to? Like, new album?
Oh, last new album?
Yeah. Not new as in just came out, but new as in you had never heard it.
Oh, probably one of LL's albums. I went through his discography the other day.
You've been trying to get me to listen to Big Pun, right? Big Pun and Big L lately.
Yeah, Big Pun, Big L.
You gotta send me recommendation, like send me album recs, because I want to listen to them.
21 has never had a bad feature in his career.
That is kind of.
I'm just going to disagree.
No. 21 does kind of slap on features. I don't like 21 Savage. He kind of brings it on features, though. He even brought it on the feature on the Gambino album that came out like a year or two ago. I'll give you. I'm not gonna say never had a bad feature. I'm not listening to enough 21 Savage features, but I'll say his features are a lot better than his songs. It's kind of like 2 Chainz. Like, remember 2 Chainz's crazy feature game?
Yeah, I don't know. It's 21 Savage. He just keeps saying 21. It really gets to me. It really fucking sends me into a fit.
Sorry.
Okay, Bryce is dying. It's my stream now.
I'm sorry. I've been trying so hard not to cough all stream.
Yeah, that's the other reason we're wrapping up is, you know, before Bryce actually keels over.
Yeah, before it gets me. Hey, everyone. Scott and I are going to start playing Apex. Is it good?
Yeah, please tell us your opinion on Apex in a calm, rational manner.
Yeah, we've been trying to find a new game to play together, like something we can play a lot because we're drowned out. We tried Apex when it came out. We fucking hated it. And then everyone's been recommend, not everyone, but like every time we look anything up, people are like, fucking play Apex. And so it made me go like, maybe we should try Apex. It was like that or Warzone, and I've heard Warzone's fucking garbage. That's why I don't We played Monster Hunter together. We played Monster Hunter World. I just don't like Monster Hunter. I'll be honest. I'm just not for me. It's not.
We played it for a couple of hours, and I had a bad time. It did not make me want to go back.
We did. We played it for a couple hours, and it took that couple hours to get to even play together. And we were very frustrated about that. I will say that. But yeah, that's like the one Capcom series I don't like. Because Capcom's like my favorite game company. I typically like everything Capcom does, but for some reason Monster Hunter, it's like Monster Hunter and Mega Man are my kryptonite when it comes to Capcom.
Kryptonite, the Three Doors Down song? You want to talk about real music?
Rubber Century, you like the track, but I don't want to click it because I don't want it to play the music through my Spotify. I don't want to get myself TOS'd. Ingo is playing Smite. That's why that bastard's not here.
How dare him?
Should we play Smite?
No.
You've never played Mega Man X? I've not played Mega Man X. Actually, no, that's a lie. I've tried playing Mega Man X. Hi, Ingo. I recently, because everyone recommended it to me, because I did said I didn't like Mega Man, I bought the Mega Man Zero thingy on PS4. I got that for literally $1 because Scott gave me a $20 gift card to GameStop. And so I just used it to buy the Mega Man thing.
Oh, yeah, because I had an extra one from when I bought a PlayStation 5.
Yeah, yeah, because that you got that, like, dumb bundle that, like, randomly gave you a GameStop gift card. So I got that for $1. And so eventually I'm going to play it. My voice is dying the more we talk.
Yeah, well... It's been fun, everybody. Good Tuesday
raid?
Stream.
Who do we raid on fucking...
Oh, shit.
4 p.m.
I need to look for that.
Yeah, start digging up someone to raid.
Echo Gillette is streaming.
We could... Doesn't she follow you?
She does. I've DM'd her before.
Raid Iago? We could do Iago.
Is Iago streaming?
Whoever you want to do, Scott.
Wait... Is Ingo streaming?
I don't know.
Ingo. No, it says Ingo's offline. Rubber Century just kept saying Ingo, so
he's saying because he's here. And Ingo's not Ingo. Oh, Ingo did address him.
Oh shit, Iago is streaming. We should raid Iago.
Yeah, we can raid Iago. That's fine. Okay.
What's his Twitch handle?
Is it Iago? Wait, see, the problem with Iago is he has like 6 Twitter accounts, so I don't know what his actual name is on anything. I love the guy, but I have such a hard time finding him.
I think he's just.
Should we start signing off before you start the right thing?
Yeah.
Okay, everyone. Yeah, we're gonna raid Iago. That'll be fun. We're gonna switch to the ending screen as we queue the raid up. I'm waiting for Scott to start it. But yeah, it was fun. We'll be back Thursday. Thursday at 5 p.m. Right, 6 p.m. Something like that. Around there. Five. We'll be back at 5 on Thursday. We'll be back next week. Do we want to say what next week's stream is, or the Thursday stream is?
Sure.
The person's going to be on it, right?
Yes. It's
big guest. Shut up. You ruined my joke. Let's just go on live. Anyway, next week's going to be all about how to grow your Twitter followers. And it's going to be Echo Saber Scott and then me with 700. So it's going to be a big stream. We're going to really help people out. And next stream is going to be how to grow your Twitter followers with Echo and Scott. And I'll be silent. Thank you, GageStop, for subscribing. If anything, I'll try and live to the next one.
Thanks, GageDot. That's it. All right.
Okay. Bye, everyone.
Bye.